he tested them. He put more pressure on them, he said, Charlesy, than he ever would riding a race. And as a horse person viewing his performance since coming back, has he lost anything because of the knees?
I don't think he has, and that's one of the biggest issues. Even for a Hall of Fame jockey like Gary Stevens, he's been away. When he comes back, declares himself sound and ready to ride again, who will believe for sure and trust him with their horses that every race counts? Neil Drasdale was one of the first to step up to the plate, put him on War Chant for his tune-up race. It was his first start since the Kentucky Derby and his shoulder injury. So in a sense, the two made a great comeback together, won the Oak Tree Mile out there, and Vince, they are now the favorite in today's mile here at Churchill Downs. So it's quite a story and a lot of confidence from Neil Drysdale.
And there is War Chant in the paddock being saddled when Neil Drysdale was schooling him yesterday before the races. He was kind of feeling good and acting up a little bit too, just as he appears to be a handful there in the saddling stall down in the paddock. By the way, one final note on the feature of Gary Stevens. He was trying to give us a tip. We just weren't smart enough to get it. That horse he was holding in the feature, it was Spain who won the distaff and paid $113. All right, we're getting ready for the Breeders' Cup Mile, and let's check the current odds. Ladies Den at 7-1, Walks Like a Duck getting some support, a 9-1 shot. Now, Indian Lodge, 11-1, King Cougat, 4-1. Some money coming in on King Cougat. Dan Silly, Arcadian Hero, Firm Success, all long shots. The favorite, War Chant. War Chant is at 3-1 to win the Breeders' Cup Mile. Back to Churchill Downs in just a moment.
Watch this. Say, Phil, who's playing tonight?
Leafs and Flyers. Habs and Bruins. Kings and Flames.
Scores?
3-2. 4-zip. 5-all.
You're a regular math prodigy.
Get Bell Express View and choose from over 1,000 games with the NHL Center Ice Package.
So, Phil, when's your anniversary?
I'm married.
Not anymore.
Call Bell Express View today.
Delco Parts.
What does it take to be a good parent?
Just because we're disabled doesn't mean that we can't at least try.
Should the mentally disabled have the right to raise children? Is love enough? Witness Tuesday at 9 on CBC.
And just a reminder, on Hockey Night in Canada, Maple Leafs in St. Louis to take on the Blues. First game of the doubleheader following Labatt Saturday night, which is at 6:30 Eastern, 3:30 on the West Coast. Game two comes from Calgary for the Calgary Flames, home to Pittsburgh. During our next break, we will talk with Tammy Samuel Belaz, now spokesman for Sampson Farm, with a passing of her father, Ernie. Right now, though, back to NBC.
And there is Gary Stevens making his walk to the paddock. He's been very successful in Breeders' Cup races here at Churchill Downs. And he will be riding the favorite War Chant in the Breeders' Cup Mile. Well, there's Julio Canani. He trains Ladies Den. And one of the delights of last year's Breeders' Cup was Silic's victory in the mile. A delight because of this man, trainer Julio Canani, the Peruvian expatriate who continues his fascinating journey today.
In my country, I used to go to the movies a lot, and I used to see New York with those big buildings. Here in this country, I did a lot of jobs. Come on, Mr. Ed. Give me your tongue. No, give me your tongue. One time I want to become a movie star, I was pumping gas, I mean, in Hollywood. Era good boy. Now you can get out, Carol. I go to Europe, Ireland, England, Canada, wherever I go, they love me.
Hey, Julio, nice hat.
I got a lot of hats all my life. I got hats, I mean, white, gray, blacks.
awkward. The girl did me this like this.
But I like hats.
Hey, let me see where my horse is, though.
I believe in luck.
Really?
You don't know how lucky I am. Everything that happened in life happened for a reason.
Do you believe what I told you?
Well, Julio doesn't have that hat on, but if that jacket looks familiar, it should. That's the lucky jacket he wore last year when Cilic won the Breeders' Cup Mile at Gulfstream Park. And he is right now talking with his jockey, Kent DeSormo, who will be riding Ladies' Den. Mutathir at 15. Ladies' Den is 7-1 now. Walks Like a Duck still at 9. King Kugat a 4-1 chance. Dan Silly 11-1. War Chant has gone down a half a notch, 7-2 now in the betting. Half is 20. Forbidden Apple and Northeast Bound each at 30-1. And the riders up command has been given as they make a circle of the paddock. Let's go to Mike Battaglia.
Thanks, Tom. And here, Neil Drysdale ready to give Gary Stevens a leg up on War Chant. And let me tell you something. War Chant has been an absolute handful here in the paddock. He's given Neil Drysdale and his handlers a bit of a fit, although he looks absolutely great. And he's ready right now to give Gary Stevens the leg up. Here we go on War Chant, and tried to get a word from Neil, but he's just too quick for me, Tom. The horse, the rider, and Neil, too quick for me. They outran me. Tom?
Listen, Neil has been too quick for a lot of media members this last week or so at Churchill Downs. He's been fairly elusive, but he has not only War Chant, of course, but Fusa Ichi Pegasus in the Classic. There is War Chant. Gary Stevens astride as the horses will make their way out of the paddock. What can you read into that, Charles? See what a horse like War Chant, who normally is very well behaved, acts up a little bit in the paddock.
Well, we've been watching him here all week this week in the stable area, and he's been very much on his toes. He's sharp, he's feeling good, he's fresh. He's only had the one race since last May, and I think he's just ready to cut loose a good race. He just wants to get it on.
Do they always give you a trumpet fanfare at ABC when you talk to him?
Well, yes. It's a matter of great importance. Timing is everything. What we might better do, Tom, is look for a long shot here at the rate these first two races have gone. Although we're on the turf now, maybe the first two upsets have been because those fillies had home court advantage. Everybody, all is fair on the turf. What they need in this race is a lot of luck. We've got 14 horses on a 7/8 of a mile turf course.
And this is the first real invasion of the Europeans here. They like the grass races. They race on grass in Europe. But what they don't do in Europe is have the tight turns of the American turf courses. How much of an adjustment is that? I know at Newmarket they have something set up where they can sort of simulate that, but is it the same thing?
Well, no, but I don't think anything really will simulate what they've got to go through here, because 14 horses, tight turns, everything happens, and it wouldn't be the first time we see maybe some of the European horses drift way wide on those turns, and a mile turf race is over in a heartbeat. It's pretty much of an all-out sprint. They can't afford to give away a thing.
And the 14 horses that will contest the mile making their way onto the track here at Churchill Downs. They always warm up, as you probably know, on the dirt track before heading to the turf just before going into the starting gate. War Chant continues to be the favorite. Neil Drysdale, the trainer. War Chant is a three-year-old who should know his way around Churchill Downs because he was here in the spring as a candidate for the Kentucky Derby. Didn't run that well, but was fancied by some as the hot horse before the Derby. And let's take a look at the horses for the mile. Number one, Mutathir from the Godolphin operation of the Maktoums, the ruling family of Dubai, where they developed an extensive training and racing operation. Group one winner in Europe, his one North American race, a fifth in Woodbine's Atto Mile. Two is Ladies' Den as Julio Canani looks for the magic of Cilic. This horse won the grade one Eddie Reed, but was fourth in the Atto Mile. Number three, Altavir, another Maktoum horse, this one from Sheikh Hamdan Shadwell stable. Racing in Europe and the U.S., he's won two of three at this mile distance on the grass. His last race was his best in the States, the Keeneland Turf Mile. Number four, walks like a duck, runs like a bear when he's on for transplanted Irishman Patrick Gallagher. He's won three of his last four, has the saddle services of Eddie D., but he steps up in class. Number five is Indian Lodge, or Galloping Off. Trained in England by Amanda Parent, a former amateur jockey whose father, Guy Harwood, was British champion trainer, though he did have a spectacular failure with the highly touted Dancing Brave at the Breeders' Cup. Indian Lodge has won two Group 1 races his last three starts, getting an early start from the post parade. makes distant music from the Jugmont farms of Saudi Prince Khalid Abdullah. Three-year-old colt, third behind Kalanisi and Monju, who will be in the turf later today. That was in the Champion Stakes in England. The seven-horse King Kugat, named for bandleader Xavier Kugat, the Mambo King. And this horse has danced into the winner's circle five of his last six starts. The Beaumont-trained three-year-old faces older rivals for the first time today. Number eight is Dan Silly, another Jugmont-owned runner. This one trained by French champion Andre Fabre. A mile is best distance, but Indian Lodge beat him his last two races. Number nine, Arcadian Hero, trained by Luca Camani, who won the 94-mile here at Churchill Downs with Barathea. This horse beaten Justin O's in the Addo Mile despite a poor start. Hasn't run, though, since September 10th. The 10-horse Affirmed Success, who tries the mile after 6th and 12th place finishes in the sprint. A newcomer to the turf, this will be his 5th start on the lawn. Appears to have found a home there, but can he perform at this high level? The 11 War Chant, and talk about turf newcomers. After running 9th here in the Derby, War Chant away from the races till October, then on the turf for the first time to win the Oak Tree Mile. Remember, Neil Drysdale trained Prize to win the 89 turf in his first grass race. War Chant's dam, by the way, Hollywood Wildcat, won the Distaff in 1993. The 12 horses Hap, and this blonde, you see his mane, hopes he has more fun. Owned by the trust of the late Alan Paulson, number one Breeders' Cup owner, saddled by Belmont. Hap, a four-race winning streak, snapped in the Kelso Handicap. 13 Forbidden Apple, owned by 85-year-old Arthur Appleton. The Silks even have an apple on them. This five-year-old could be tough if he can run back to his last two races in New York, the Belmont Breeders' Cup Handicap and the Kelso Handicap. In 14 is Northeast Bound, winner in five of his seven races this year, most at his New Jersey base, but he takes a giant step up in class today. That's the field for the Breeders' Cup Mile. And let's go down to our handicappers who are still licking their wounds after two big long shots, Mike and Bob.
That's true. I know somebody that had those two winners.
Oh, come on.
My mother. She likes to put names with stories. And in a particularly tender moment, vacationing with my dad in Lisbon, she had Caressing and Spain.
No.
I can't make that up.
All right. Bob's mother's the only handicapper I know that could have picked those two. That's right.
Post position is an issue here in the mile. Maybe the only Breeders' Cup event that is the case. And you see, the inside is the place to be. Posts 1 through 6, 11 of our 16 winners over time. And 11 through 14, not the best spot. Only 3 of 16 winners. That's where one of our favorites, War Chant, will start today. But, you know, you look at the inside horses, and I kind of like Julio Canani. He's a horse a little bit ladies' in. But, hey, if you can't beat him, join him. Let's go for the long shot, that Altabir. And there is this horse, and I think he's coming up to this race in good shape. His jockey, Richard Migliori, has never won a race in the Breeders' Cup. His trainer, Kieran McLaughlin, has never won a race in the Breeders' Cup. His owner, Shadwell Stables, have never won a race in the Breeders' Cup. Time to get off the schneid today.
Well, you know what? I'm going to take a horse and a jockey and a trainer that has won in the Breeders' Cup. That's Bill Mott and Jerry Bailey with King Kugat. King Kugat, a three-year-old in here. It's just an excellent race record. 9 starts, 6 wins, and 3 second-place finishes. He loves the turf course here at Churchill Downs. He's undefeated in 2 starts here. He won the Crown Royal American Turf on Oaks Day of this year and looked awesome doing it. I think the 1 mile distance is going to suit him perfect. He got caught behind a dawdling pace last time out, still got up to win the race, and I've been very, very impressed with him. Jerry Bailey had his choice of Hap or King Kugat. He's going with King Kugat, so am I.
Is one of the race favorites. This is War Chant, a son of Danzig. His return to the races on the turf out in California, gangbusters. But again, that post outside, can he overcome that today? A little nervous, as Mike pointed out, in the paddock, but the crafty trainer, Neil Drysdale, he of Fusa Ichi Pegasus fame, we'll talk a lot about him later, certainly a prime contender.
Yeah, and you know what, he was nervous in the paddock, but he absolutely looked great in the paddock once he got settled. There's Indian Lodge, one of the European horses, and I think this horse has a pretty solid chance in here also. If he takes to the Churchill Downs turf course, I think he's dangerous at odds of 12 to 1, Tom.
All right, guys, and there have been a lot of upsets on history in the mile, so maybe we'll see another one here. War Chant is drawing most of the cybercappers' attention. Affirmed Success is their second choice, and Mike's pick, King Kugat, comes in third. Through the first 16 runnings, the average winning mutual in the mile has been $18. Will it be more today?
And as NBC goes to break, we stay live at Churchill. Over the years, there have been three Canadian-bred winners in the Breeders' Cup. Two have come from Sampson Farm. It was here that Dan Smartley won the Distaff in 1991, and who remembers, or who forgets, rather, the Chief out in California, Chief Bearhart in the Turf. A sad day for Canadian racing this year with the passing of Ernie Samuel, the head of Sampson Farm. We spoke with his daughter, Tammy Samuel Belaz, here at Churchill yesterday.
It's been a very difficult year, you're right. You know, on a personal level, losing Dad is just unbelievably sad. At the same time, we've had the most incredible race year with some of the most unbelievable highlights that you could ask for. So it's been a year with highs and lows, and yet racing was what Dad was all about and what he loved. So for us, you know, when you're feeling a little bit sad, you're thinking he would be loving this, and that picks us all up a little bit and gives us the motivation to do it for him. And, you know, I know he's watching, and hopefully we make him proud.
Jim, Ernie Samuel, not only a great impact on thoroughbred racing in our country, but also on this event.
Well, that's right, and he understood how important the Breeders' Cup would be, and he knew right away that when this was going to be a great event, he went to the very first one with his champion, Dauphine Royale. Very, very good horse, and he has supported it, he has won at it, and he has been very influential on the board of directors of the Breeders' Cup.
All right, let's move to the next race, the Mile. It's on the turf. There have been some long shot winners. How about your picks? And I hope you've got a long shot in this race.
Well, I do have a long shot. It's Arcadian Hero, who ran at Woodbine and got left in the gate in the Atto Mile, and we'll see if the horse can go just a little bit better here. We have Ladies Din, who also ran in the Atto Mile, and last year a horse from the Atto's Mile, Silic, who was out of the money, came to win this race. We'll see if they can do it here in War Chant, who is everybody's pick.
Jim, just a couple of seconds. Why so many upsets today?
Couple of things. These are all very good horses on Breeders' Cup Day, so don't differentiate because you have a horse that's at a long price. And the people that originate information in this game, if they're wrong, everybody's wrong, and so far those that originate it have been wrong.
Up next, it's the Mile on the Turf, and once again, we rejoin our colleagues at NBC.
Back at Churchill Downs before the Breeders' Cup Mile. Update the odds. Ladies Din 7-1. King Cougat continues to get play at 7-2 now. 11-1 on Dan Silly. War Chant also 7-2. Co-favorite now with King Cougat. And Charlie, again, we look at a wide open race. A firm success, a Breeders' Cup veteran. He's been in the sprint a couple times.
He has. He's invented himself more times than Madonna. He was a three-year-old classic contender 3 years ago. Then he became a sprinter. Then he became a miler. Now he's a turf horse. He's in here on the turf because the sprint is too short for him on the dirt, and the mile and a quarter classic is too long. The mile turf fits him just right. And he's tough. He's got a very versatile running style, which will suit him well in this difficult positioning race.
War Chant balking a little bit at going in. Donna, he's kind of a handful in the paddock. How's he been in the last few minutes?
War Chant's been super in the post parade, as have all the European horses as well, but he was a little stirred up in the paddock. Gary took him without the pony in the post parade. He's been beautiful.
All right, let's go to Tom Durkin for the call of the Breeders' Cup Mile.
For Bit and Apple, moving into post position number 13, and northeast bound at 40-1. Not to be dismissed today, the way the payoffs have been, as northeast bound is the final to load here in this field of 14. They've got a run here at Churchill Downs of just a bit more than one furlong before they hit that very crucial first turn in the mile race. Still waiting for Arcadian Hero acting up just a little bit in the starting gate. Arcadian Hero, who was off to a very difficult start in his last race in Canada, the Atto Mile, a little fractious in the starting gate. He has two assistant starters in there with him. Jockey Jamie Spencer, Ward, trying to settle down the rest of Arcadian Hero. Diddy's still tossing his head about, very uncomfortable about something, as jockey Jamie success. And from post 14 northeastbound is up and after the lead as they race for the clubhouse turn. And it is northeastbound who wins the race in the turn. And he clears the speedy and firm success by two lengths. Forbidden Apple up close, and he's very keen today. Hard held. Then toward the inside, Mutat there saving ground. Half three wide and moving up. Out to Beer under a hard hold there. Stout restraint, and he's resenting it. Walks like a duck, passes him now to race up in sixth position. Out to Beer is now racing seventh. Long-legged Ladies Den gets in the clear on the outside. Indian Lodge moves up a spot or two toward the rail. And then it's Distant Music and Dan Silly. They're running together about 10 lengths from the lead, followed by Arcadian Hero. Jamie Spencer riding high on him now as they save ground. War Chant and King Kugat, the two favorites, are 13th and 14th after a half that went only in 47 and 4/5 seconds. The advantage to northeastbound, the leader, and he's going strong. 40-1 in front around the far turn. A firm success is second. Move top here on the inside third. Half on the outside fourth. Forbidden Apple, Indian Lodge down toward the inside. Walks like a duck on the extreme outside, and Distant Music into the final furlong now. Northeastbound digs down deep, and he's tenaciously holding on to the lead. A firm success is right in his gauntlet. Here comes Mutat here, and with giant strides, War Chant is flying as they come to the finish. Here's the winner, War Chant coming from 13th in this field, and a fine finish as well for Dan Silly. Those two finish in a photo right there in the photo as well. Long shot, northeastbound, and a firm success, a thriller in the mile. The final time here was 1:34 and 3/5 seconds. This was a remarkable effort for War Chant, coming from far off an easy pace, and a remarkable effort for a jockey that's not too bad coming out of retirement time, Evan.
Gary Stevens aboard War Chant, who came flying into a slow pace to win it in only his second start on grass. He's 2-for-2 now on the lawn. Donna?
Gary Stevens, you come out of retirement and with a bang. Congratulations.
Thank you. I can't say enough that Neil Drysdale gave me a hell of an opportunity to put me on this horse, and I'm ecstatic. It's a dream come true, I'll tell you.
Did you expect to be that far back?
Well, he's pushed button. He's got an unbelievable turn of foot. Just rode him with confidence.
As always, confident Gary Stevens. Back to you, Tom.
Okay, Donna. Well, and what about Neil Drysdale? What a training feat. You remember when he had prize to win the Breeders' Cup Turf in 1989. It was his first start on turf. This is only the second start for the three-year-old War Chant on grass, and he closes with a rush to win the Breeders' Cup Mile. Northeastbound and a firm success appeared to have it their own way, but here comes War Chant under a drive from Gary Stevens, closing on the outside. War Chant in the final strides gets up to win the Breeders' Cup Mile. And the owners, Marjorie and Irving Cowan, watching their homebred, a three-year-old Danzig colt from Breeders' Cup winner Hollywood Wildcat by Chris S., get the money in the Breeders' Cup Mile. War Chant, is it Drysdale's day?
When the clothing arrives for the new season, it's always exciting for me. You see, I do windows. This year, there's a great selection of khakis, long-sleeve knits, sweaters, and leather jackets. My job is to make sure you look when you walk by. Sometimes I'll even stand there myself, just to see if you're paying attention. I love that part.
Seasonal fashions, now at Moore's.
Well-made, well-priced, well-dressed. Moore's.
One day, I'll have a wife and three kids. No, two kids and a dog. Well, maybe a wife. Or maybe not.
Identity crisis? Camry. Solera. The new Solera convertible. Three fast ways to find yourself.
Over 70 million people
are receiving an education on the internet this year.
7 out of 10 students on the web
say they are getting better grades.
One day, training for every job on earth.
Training for every job on earth will be available on the internet.
Are you ready?
Are you ready?
Are you ready?
Virtually all internet traffic travels across the systems of one company, Cisco Systems. Impact.
powering the internet generation.
Are you ready?
Are you?
From the creators of Listerine comes a weapon so revolutionary, it will kill evil breath bacteria.
Say ah.
Anytime, anywhere. New Listerine Pocket Packs. The action hero for a cleaner mouth.
The road to the Grey Cup just got harder.
The Toronto Argonauts go head-to-head with Eastern rivals the Montreal Alouettes.
The CFL on CBC, Sunday at 1 Eastern.
Cup mile, and the photo sign separating second and third just now went up. Northeastbound second, Don Silly finished third, but Warchant has given Gary Stevens his eighth Breeders' Cup win. Let's go down to Trevor.
Tom, what a tremendous stretch run. It invariably happens on the turf that we come up with these blanket finishes, and it happened again here. Let's take a look right here. Here's the eventual winner, Warchant. Here's King Cougar on the extreme outside. This is Walks Like a Duck here with a shadow roll on, and down on the inside we have Northeastbound and Affirm Success are the two horses on the inside. But again, let's watch Warchant here as Gary Stevens takes him to the outside. You see his ears right there looking up. He's going to go for a heel right here. There might have been a little bit of contact right there as he almost clipped the heels of number four, Walks Like a Duck. He straightens out, and on the outside, you see King Cougat there. His left front foot caught the right back of Warchant. So King Cougat unlucky there as he was starting to unwind his run. You saw him clip heels there. Nothing too serious, but it obviously killed his momentum, and that didn't help King Cougat. But just look at Warchant now. This horse's acceleration is absolutely unbelievable. He is powerhousing past a top-class field here, a world-class field. And look at him. He's going past them like he just joined in at the quarter pole. You'd think he was a fresh horse, and he had waited for them to catch up to him. He's just flying by them. Huge run from that big long shot northeastbound, but Gary Stevens times it to perfection, and it's Warchant up to win in the final few jumps. The 40-1 long shot northeastbound second. Third was Dan Silly. He came like a rocket at the rail too. And fourth was a firm success. And there's Gary Stevens and Warchant in the winner's circle.
So Gary Stevens gets his eighth Breeders' Cup win, back from retirement. There were questions about his knees, questions about his insurance settlement. He answered all those questions with an affirmative, resounding performance today aboard Warchant. Remember, Warchant was acting up in the paddock, looked like he was going to be a problem. He ran today one of the strongest moves we've seen in some time on the turf course, finishing with a rush to give Gary Stevens a welcome back from his brief retirement. It was rides like that, I think, that convinced Gary he had to come back. He missed it so much. And what about Neil Drysdale, who saddles the winner? He has the highest winning percentage in Breeders' Cup history. That's his sixth winner, and he has Fusa Ichi Pegasus, the favorite in the Classic, still to come today. Chelsea, you have to take your hat off to Neil Drysdale and to Gary Stevens for their performance.
A sensational race, but let's think about one thing. There were a great many doubters who said, could Warchant be ready off only one prep race since May? The same people who are saying, can Fusa Ichi Pegasus be ready on soft works for the Mile and a Quarter Classic? Watch out.
All right, let's go to Bob Neumeier.
Gary Stevens is the type of rider that's always worn his heart on his sleeve. I've seen you in this winner's circle. We've talked many times before. Your emotions now following this big win off the comeback trail.
I'm in shock just being here today, let alone winning a Breeders' Cup race. That's three on the day for me, and the confidence that Mr. Drysdale and the cowmen showed in putting me on this animal, I mean, that says a lot, and it just gave me confidence in myself, and I'm just happy to be here.
Gary, there was a little incident in the turn involving King Cougat, possible clipping of heels, etc. Could you comment at all about that?
Everyone knew this race was going to be rough. I mean, I was drawn on the outside. Neil asked me what I was going to do. So I'm going to ride him like I did last time. He's push button. I said, we've got no chance if I send him and get six wide. We were last with some slow fractions, and Neil commented that, you know, he was worried, and I was a bit worried, but you saw the kind of move this horse had through the stretch, and I had Ladies Den in front of me. I felt like he was going to be one to beat, and when I pushed the button on him, his last eighth of a mile was just unbelievable.
Well, he did it with DeHaas in the mile, and he's done it again. Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Okay, Gary Stevens back in a big way. Tom?
Bob, and with that eighth Breeders' Cup win, he becomes the second leading Breeders' Cup jockey. Let's go to Mike Battaglia for the presentation.
Thanks, Tom. Winning owners, Marge and Irv Cowan, and to make the presentation, chairman of the board here at Churchill Downs, Mr. Will Farish. Mr. Farish.
Thank you, Irv. Congratulations to both of you and Neil on a brilliant race.
Well, I'm still breathless. I can't believe that the horse accelerated as quickly as he did, and Gary did a great job. And without the horse, you got nothing.
And Irv, what about the training job done by Mr. Neil Drysdale? Neil,
that's fantastic.
What a job. One race since the Derby, one grass race in his life, and he comes back and he runs this kind of race, comes from dead last. I know you've been high on him, but did you expect that kind of effort?
Well, he's a very talented colt, and he's got a lovely turn of foot, so I was just glad that he was able to do it on the right day.
And who's the best three-year-old in your barn right now?
Well,
look at Neil backing off.
Mr. Drysdale, this is the second Breeders' Cup that he's won for my wife and myself, and this colt happens to be the son of the first one, Hollywood Wildcat.
Hollywood Wildcat, congratulations again. All right, Tom, back to you.
All right, Mike, way to put the pressure on him. War Chant goes back to the barn and says to Fusaichi, cop this if you can. He paid $9, $6, $4.40 northeastbound, and Dan Silly, the exact of $4.86, the triple $14,000. Well, the fans here at Churchill Downs have gotten quite a treat. The first three races, two huge upsets, and then a brilliant move by War Chant. As you see, the official order of finish in the Breeders' Cup Mile. King Cougat finishing 11th, unlucky to have clipped heels and lost his momentum. And the paddock is always a focal point because it's here that the horses for the Breeders' Cup Sprint will be making their appearance shortly. And the morning line odds, more than ready, 6-1. Trippy at 8-1. A pair of three-year-olds there. Caller 1 at 3-1. Five-star day, 8-1 on the morning line. Bet on Sunshine at 12.
Now it's time to write your attention.
Elaborate it. And successful appeal at 15. Kona Gold opens as the 5-2 favorite. And the others, long shots in the 6-furlong Breeders' Cup Sprint. Well, now to get you caught up on all that's going on this afternoon in the sports world, back to the Sun America Sports Desk, and let's join Dan Hicks.
And as NBC joins Dan Hicks to update college football, we will take a commercial break. When we return live to Churchill, Jim Bannon on the possibility of the Breeders' Cup coming back to Toronto. It was at Woodbine in 1996. Back in Louisville after this.
It has been completely redesigned, so it is more powerful, safer, quieter, and more spacious. With ultra-low emissions and improved fuel economy. Introducing the all-new Civic from Honda. Amazing, but true.
Why can't they park in the garage like everyone else?
We all start out with dreams. As you explore life's opportunities, the right planning and advice can make them a reality. Standard Life can help you now to realize your childhood dreams and turn your investments into a roaring success. Realize your childhood dreams and more. Standard Life. Profit from our knowledge.
We're really big on harvest festivals. Call for your guide.
Mobile One has been tested on the racetrack and in the lab. Now comes the real test, Canadian winter. In cold temperatures, most conventional motor oils gel up, making it hard to start. Not Mobile One. It flows freely at minus 35 degrees and protects your engine. A Canadian winter, the toughest test of them all. Nothing outperforms Mobile One. Available at PartSource.
This kid is our last hope.
He's got nowhere to go but up.
Because we're going to Mars, we should take along a guy from Mars?
Can we do that again?
Disney's Rocket Man, Sunday at 5 on CBC Television.
Are we there yet?
Grace's life takes a turn.
She's perfect.
Is it love at first sight?
Is this where you want to spend the rest of your life?
Van has asked me to marry him.
You've only known him for 5 days.
Wind at My Back, Sunday night at 7 on CBC.
Breeders' Cup came to Woodbine. It was a success in every way. I'm a little surprised, and you'll tell me why I'm surprised in a minute, tell the viewers, that they're talking about going back to Woodbine.
Well, they are, and one of the big concerns is the changes they've made at Woodbine, and there's several changes they've made, many of them good. They've certainly refurbished the place, and it looks great and is very functional, but space is limited. Breeders' Cup, though, is not too concerned about jamming Woodbine with a whole bunch of people because they're looking for a great studio for the Breeders' Cup, and Woodbine can do that. In addition, Woodbine has that beautiful E.P. Taylor turf course, and with three of the races now on the turf, Woodbine would be the ideal host and has already done it before, and Breeders' Cup is comfortable having Woodbine in that roster.
You talked about that E.P. Taylor turf course. Without question, it is the best turf course in all of North America, and of course the Europeans like. Jim, the sprint is up next. We have a Canadian-owned horse, Elaborate, in that race. How about your picks?
Well, Elaborate's a pretty decent horse from California, owned by Canadian interests. Toffin and McCaffrey, we'll see how this goes. It's a tough one. Collar One has good speed, but there is other good speed in the race. Kona Gold is a horse that comes up to this race in great shape. He's been to the Breeders' Cup twice before. We'll see if Trippy has a chance, but I look this for a battle between Collar One and Kona Gold.
Well, the sprint is up next. Still to come, the turf for fillies and mares. That's the one with great Canadian connections, including Perfect Sting, owned by Frank Stronach. Right now, let's go back to NBC.
Tom Hammond sitting just under those twin spires at Churchill Downs, 12 minutes from post time for the Breeders' Cup sprint, the next race on this 17th Breeders' Cup card. And that's the jam-packed paddock. Those are the fans looking in to see the horses saddled for the sprint. And let's give you an update on the odds for the 6-furlong Breeders' Cup sprint. The main track very fast. We could see a track record here. More Than Ready is 3-1, Trippy at 9-1, and Collar One is a 6-1 shot. Five Star Day 14. 9-5 is Kona Gold. He's the 9-5 favorite. Agnes World at 17-1 has really been all over the world. There's Five Star Day being saddled by Bo Greeley, 29-year-old trainer, and kicking up his heels a little bit. Now being joined by Garrett Gomez, who will ride him. And that is Kona Gold, the favorite. Kona Gold is running in the sprint for the third time, and it's all become old hat for this veteran. He takes it all in stride.
He's always been extremely laid-back horse, very easy to train, very sweet, and very easy to gallop. He doesn't pull, he doesn't put any pressure on himself. The first year we came here, he wasn't very seasoned, and we had to wait to the last minute even to get in.
Kona Gold Grand Slam, here's the line. Re-raise, got it!
Last year, I don't want to take anything away from Art Tax, he's a great horse, but the ground did slip out from under him, and he did bobble at the start, and that set him back quite a ways off the pace.
Art Tax, the winner by a head. Kona Gold second.
This year, we set up a plan, and luckily the plan went on course.
That's Kona Gold in full flight for the wire, and now he opens up.
I like that cliche, the third time's a charm. This time we have a nice outside post position, all the speed's inside, and he's in supreme condition. So I look for him to run, maybe break the track record.
Well, that track record might be within reach because this main track has been playing very fast. Alex Solis is getting some final instructions from Bruce Headley. And let's go to Mike.
Ed, Tom, we're here with Nick Zito. Nick's settling a bit of a long shot in this race in Valiant Howler. He's got a couple of Pretty good favorites coming up shortly. Tell us a little bit about Valiant Haller and how he's coming into this race.
Well, he's very consistent, Mike, and, you know, a day like today with the great Gary Stevens, who knows? Why not?
And Stevens is hot. He's already had. Does he know he's got three wins today already?
No, he just wants some more.
Give him a leg up.
Let's walk up.
All right, Tom, there he goes. Nick Zito giving Gary Stevens that leg up, looking for his fourth win of the day.
Yeah, Gary did ride a two on the preliminary races and has a Breeders' Cup victory to his credit. Let's check with Bob.
One of our favorites is More Than Ready. He's trained by the fine young conditioner Todd Pletcher, who also saddles Trippy in today's sprint. More Than Ready was a very fast two-year-old, a nice fourth in the Derby, and he's being held in very high regard today, Todd. A change of equipment recently involving shoes. Can you explain?
Well, my blacksmith and I thought his walls were getting just a little bit chewed up, and we were concerned that the nails might not bite into the hoof well enough to make sure that he was going to make it around there with all four shoes on. So in his two front shoes, we added an acrylic compound that just kind of adds a little wall to the foot. It's the same thing, same product that you hear people gluing shoes on with. Well, we didn't actually glue them on. We put it on the outside walls and then drove the nails into that.
He ran with those shoes, I'm told, in the Vosburg, ran a tremendous race. Do we presume that this would not compromise his chances for those folks out there that like More Than Ready today?
Not in any way.
Okay, Todd Pletcher, the trainer of More Than Ready and Trippy. Two good chances to win the sprint here today.
A little bad luck, though, for Todd in the post position draw, drawing posts one and two, More Than Ready in one, Trippy in two. Charlesy, in a sprint like this, when you're on the inside, logically you would think that was good, but you really have to come out of the gate or you can get pinched off.
Well, Trippy wants to go to the lead, so he'll really have to gun away from there, really have to use him. We've got enormous early speed in caller one and five-star day, and those two are destined to go head-and-head. It has been declared they will be flying on the lead, so we're going to have a lot of pace here. Trippy may not quite be able to keep pace with them, but it's interesting, Todd Pletcher's entry, the one and two, Trippy and More Than Ready, the last time we saw them here at Churchill Downs, they were going postward in the Kentucky Derby at a mile and a quarter. Here they are a few months later, they're top sprinters with a big chance in the sprint.
There's a look at a More Than Ready. And as you said, a lot of the debate has been who will make the lead. Will it be caller one or will it be five-star day?
Well, these two young men who train these horses, James Chapman and Bo Greeley, and not that the young are impetuous, but they're both 29 years old. They both think they've got the fastest horse, and they both are probably right. I think that caller one probably is a little quicker. Five-star day can tend to break a hair slow, but he's going to be right with him, and the two of them will show the way.
There's More Than Ready, now wearing his third hat, a precocious two-year-old, a classic contender, ran fourth in the Derby, and now back to his best role, perhaps, as a sprinter. Last two races at 7/8 were good. Trippy is by In Sweep, named for the former Georgia football star Charlie Trippy, by Dogwood Stable founder Cott Campbell, who pioneered large syndicates of novice owners. His autobiography, Lightning in a Jar, just published. Trippy beat More Than Ready in the Vosburg. Number three, caller one, Jim Chapman says he'll make the lead. And one of the co-breeders of this colt, John Gaines, who thought up the Breeders' Cup concept. Caller one undefeated this year in five races at 7 furlongs or less. Number four, Shadowcaster, owned by the Gatsis Brothers of Manchester, New Hampshire. This colt has raced mostly in New England, but is high a biggest score in Saratoga's four-go handicap. Number five is five-star day. Bo Greeley trains him. He was upset when the colt was not invited by the Breeders' Cup committee last year. Again, this year he didn't have enough points, but he was invited. He fractured his right hind leg earlier this year. Two surgical screws were implanted, but he's only had two races all year long. Number six, Bet on Sunshine, an 8-year-old gelding. He was third in 97 sprints, not invited last year, but here he is on the track. He's been out of the money only once in 13 starts at Churchill Downs, and has won half his 36 career races. Number seven is Valiant Haller from the Celtic Pride Stable, put together by Rick Pitino. Sprinting is his game, but he's never won a stakes race. Number eight, Elaborate. This is the same owner-trainer combination that had APSA run fifth in the sprint 2 years ago. Elaborate, a closer looking for the early speed to set it up. Number nine, Successful Appeal. John T.L. Jones bought a half interest in this colt. After today, he'll purchase the remaining 50% and stand him at his Walmack farm. He was beaten by Trippy in the Vosburg. 5 of 6, though, at the 6-furlong distance. His only loss was a fifth in last year's sprint. Number 10, Kona Gold. Will the third time be the charm for him? He's been a monster in 5 starts this year. 4 of them are wins, including his last 3 in a row. Number 11, Agnes World, left the paddock early and is there by himself. The co-owner of Autonomy names all his horses. races with the word Agnes included for the Hong Kong-born pop singer of the 70s, Agnes Chan. This horse has lived up to the world part of his name, too, racing all over the globe, becoming the first Japanese-trained horse to win a Group 1 race in England. He looks like he's overseas now. He's so far away from the others, he can be a real handful, so they put him off by himself. Number 12, Dream Supreme, three-year-old filly owned by the Kinsman stable of George Steinbrenner. Like his Yankees, this filly has won three in a row, but takes on the big boys today. 13, Honest Lady, the second filly in the field. She's faced the males three times, but has never beaten them. Hall of Fame trainer Bobby Frankel still in search of his first Breeders' Cup win. And number 14, Delaware Township, who earned a shot at the sprint with a victory in the Forest Hills Handicap at Belmont. His first graded stakes win, the same race Artax used as a prep for his sprint win last year. And that's the field for the Breeders' Cup Sprint. Let's check in with handicappers Mike and Bob.
All right, thanks, Thomas. If these races haven't been tough enough so far, the sprint is always a tough race. And, you know, you not only need a fast horse, but you need to get a good track. Look at the head-on of last year's race leaving the gate at Gulfstream, Bob.
For our West Coast fans, this kind of looks like Highway 5 in L.A. to me, Mike.
Yeah, I mean, you just really have, if you get in any little bit of trouble, you can lose your chance to win the race. That's why I went for a horse that I think can stay out of trouble, and there he is on the racetrack. Caller 1. This horse can fly leaving the starting gate. He's undefeated at 6 furlongs. He's never lost a race at this distance, and look at the way he wins them. His margin of victory, 10, 5, 4.5. He doesn't just win races at 6 furlongs. He annihilates the rest of the field. There's plenty of other speed in here, but I think he is the speed of the speed, Bob.
Check him out in hole number 2. He doesn't break that alertly in the Kentucky Cup Sprint, but whoosh, he just flies to the lead. He's never been headed. The key is, will he get the lead, or will five-star Day get the lead? If it's a hellacious speed duel up front, could set it up for our race favorite.
Right, Kona Gold is the 8-5 favorite, and deservedly so. He's never run a bad race. He's third in this race 2 years ago, second in the race last year, looking to win it this year, Bob.
And he has a nice outside post. That's where you want to be with a closer, as opposed to a More Than Ready that has to find room on the rail. Trippy will be a factor again. The sprint is always an interesting race. We look for the same
Call
this year. Tom?
All right, guys, let's check the Cyber Capper's pick. They like Kona Gold as well, 34%. More Than Ready, the three-year-old, and Trippy, his stablemate, drawing some attention. Both the handicappers, though, like the speedy Caller 1. Back for the Breeders' Cup Sprint right after these messages.
There are over 800,000 job openings
for internet specialists right now.
3 million more in the next 5 years. By the time I'm 18.
By the time I'm 18, over 1 billion jobs will require internet skills.
Are you ready?
Are you ready?
Virtually all internet traffic travels across the systems of one company, the same one sponsoring thousands of networking academies. Cisco Systems, empowering the internet generation.
We're ready!
Are you?
Mean that you can be confident that you're going to walk into our store and find the best price in town.
If you find a better price anywhere else, we'll beat that price. But no questions asked.
We will match it and then beat it.
That's our guarantee, day in and day out.
Everybody says they got the lowest price.
Not only do we have the guaranteed low price, we also have the knowledgeable salespeople on the floor to help you.
We want to be the best price, the best customer service, the best quality product. We want to have the best of everything.
You would be out of your mind if you shop someplace else.
$75 after Fido rebate.
starting gate for the $1 million Breeders' Cup Sprint. And let's check the current odds. More Than Ready at 9-2, Trippy is 9-1, Caller One a 4-1 shot at the moment. And Kona Gold continues to rule as the favorite at 8-5 in his third try at the Breeders' Cup Sprint. There's a look at Kona Gold. The sprint is a 6-furlong dash, the most prevalent distance at American racetracks. One turn, 3/4 of a mile to the finish here at Churchill Downs. Artax set the Breeders' Cup record last year. Will the 6-furlong track record at Churchill Downs in place since 86 fall today? Donna Barton Brothers, I should say. Is everything all in order behind the starting gate?
Yes, I am. I'll tell you what, for the fastest sprinters in the world, thoroughbred-wise anyway, I can't believe how calm, cool, and collected they are as they load into the gate, Tom.
Do they kind of get on edge just like a sprinter would be at the Olympics for the 100 meters? Are they really fired up and on their toes as they go into the gate?
Well, I guess they're waiting to get into the gate to get set on their starting block because they're coming up to the gate like it's just routine.
Charlsie?
Well, the start is incredibly important in the sprint, and we saw in the juvenile fillies race when Cash Deal went down on her nose, these horses want to get away from this gate as quickly as possible, but the first 4 or 5 strides away from the gate, the thoroughbred is actually up on his tiptoes. He's pulling on his toes. That's why Cash Deal knuckled and stumbled, and the start is really, really important for these guys here because every step is a running one in a sprint.
Valiant Hallery in Rick Pitino's Celtic Pride stable colors. Being coaxed into the gate by the assistant starters. And for the Breeders' Cup sprint call, let's go to Tom Durkin.
And the 14th sprinter to go into the starting gate is Delaware Township. Delaware Township in, ready for the start. The 2000 sprint, and they're off. Shadowcaster pricks alertly from mid-pack. Kona Gold is also right there. Trippy, there goes Caller One, and Caller One dashes to be the early leader. Trippy comes away second on the inside, Shadowcaster third, Kona Gold hustled up to be fourth. Five-star day, broke back in fifth position today. And then on the outside, Dream Supreme is running in sixth. The Japanese speedball, Agnes World, is now back running in seventh. Successful Appeal is 8-5-5. More Than Ready is ninth, better than 12 lengths from the lead. Delaware Township is now running 10th, followed by Honest Lady, Bet on Sunshine, Valiant Hillary, and Elaborate Trails the field. A wild first quarter of 20 at 4/5 seconds. Caller One, full throttle, approaching the top of the stretch, leads by two. Kona Gold powers up now second. Dream Supreme on the outside third. Trippy down toward the rail is fourth. Shadowcaster has dropped back to fifth. Successful Appeal sixth. More Than Ready is threading his way through between horses there. Agnes World, Honest Lady coming on the outside. Bet on Sunshine is coming toward the rail. And it is Caller One trying to cut it out another furlong as Kona Gold surges. And Honest Lady and Elaborate close in. It's Kona Gold in front. And Kona Gold has won it by a diminishing half a length as the filly Honest Lady charges up to be second. Bet on Sunshine was third. And the time, a new Breeders' Cup, a new Churchill Downs track record. A sensational 107-3.
Track record did indeed fall as Kona Gold in his third try made it the charm. Look at him, Alex Solis, as he's bowing his neck. He came rushing through the stretch to get Caller One, and Alex Solis and Kona Gold have taken it after finishing third, second, and first, the logical progression. Winning the Breeders' Cup Sprint in 107-3. Donna?
Alex, your horse just set a new Breeders' Cup record in the sprint. You went in 107-3. The knock on this horse was that he hadn't run with full fields. What do they say about him now?
Well, I don't care. I just believe this is the best horse in America right now. And I want to dedicate this race to my family, Tiffany, Andy, and Alex, and Austin, my wife, Sheila. Thank you, guys, for your support. I love you.
All right, I can't keep up with that one, Tom. Back to you.
Well, nobody could keep up with Kona Gold either. Solis with his first Breeders' Cup victory. And Kona Gold. Yes, he is the best sprinter in America. He's been sensational all year long. He'd never been able to break through to the top money in the Breeders' Cup, though he had been knocking on the door. Today, he opens the door and goes through, and he hangs up. Churchill Downs, 6 furlongs in a zipping 107-3. Here's Alex Solis driving the hand ride and the celebration as he wins his first Breeders' Cup race. So Kona Gold finally gets there. The connections couldn't be happier. They got it done on the third try.
What's taking the vacuum cleaner world by storm? Cyclone power. And who started it all? Phantom, the people who brought cyclone power to the world. The Phantom Fury vacuum.
I was in the cleaning service for about 18 years. It really is the best vacuum cleaner I've ever used in my life.
Only the power of two cyclones gives you the power of a Phantom vacuum.
It's amazing. It picks up everything.
Cyclone power with incredible maneuverability, flexibility, and the versatility of the Phantom Vacuum's exclusive squeeze-and-go cleaning wand.
I couldn't believe how much it did. And you don't have to have bags.
And a state-of-the-art HEPA filter.
This machine works better than any machine I've ever worked with or used, ever.
Call and get a free video of the Phantom Fury vacuum and discover the cyclone power and versatility of a Phantom from the people who brought cyclone power to the world. Call now.
Take in the reds, the golds, and the greens. Call for your guide.
Got some extra stuff you don't need? Well, you can forget the classifieds. Bring it to Cash Converters and get cash for it instantly. You'll probably also find stuff you do want. Discover Cash Converters, a better way to sell, a great place to shop.
Big on harvest festivals. Call for your guide.
And on this Saturday afternoon, you're watching CBC's live coverage of the Breeders' Cup from here in Churchill Downs in Louisville. Filianis Lady closing strongly to get second, but trainer Bobby Franklin now 0 for 35 at the Breeders' Cup. Bet on Sunshine got third. Well, it looked like Shadowcaster outbroke Caller One, but as if challenged, Caller Run ran the first sub 21 quarter in Breeders' Cup history, 20-4. Some race, Trevor Denman.
Oh, that sure was. Caller One just needs a 5-furlong Breeders' Cup race, and he had finished up in the winner's circle, but it's run at 6 furlongs, and what a magnificent horse this Kona Gold is. Just remarkable. A 6-year-old. Here he is right here in the white cap. That's Kona Gold and Alex Solis. And you know, here's Caller One on the lead, incidentally. He runs a game race, but is going to weaken late, and it's going to be Kona Gold in the white colors here. Just another incredible run. And talking about Ophirs, Alex Solis was 0 for 31 coming into this one. Such a great rider. He had never won the Breeders' Cup, but when you get this guy anywhere near the leader, he is as tenacious as a racehorse can be. Look at those ears. That is just a self-portrait in determination. The mare, Honest Lady, coming with a great run on the outside, but Kona Gold just absolutely remarkable today. And what a training job by Bruce Headley. Perhaps not that well known outside of California, but one of the greatest horsemen in America, Bruce Headley. What a great job he's done with Kona Gold. Let's take it down to Kenny Rice.
Thank you very much, Trevor. And this, the fastest Breeders' Cup sprint, possibly the fastest closing horse, came in second today. That was Honest Lady. She's ridden by Kent DeSormo. Kent, they were flying in front of you.
Well, it really set up nice. It's unfortunate she didn't get the job done today because she just ran out of ground. You know, I just feel bad for Bobby because I think he had the best horse in the race. And unfortunately, turning for home, if I would have been able to split just one horse, I might have made the difference. But
turning for home, we're not really seeing you much right now.
Yeah, here she comes. She just came into the screen, and she's absolutely making two strides to the winner's one. The difference was turning for home, I had to go around a pair instead of splitting them. And I think that was the difference between winning and finishing second.
When you knew that they were going out fast, you probably didn't realize it was a 20-4 opening quarter, but you knew they were blistering it out there, and you thought that set it up for them.
Well, you know what the best indication was of an honest pace was leaving the gate. I could hear riders smooching and hollering and screaming to get their best strides from their horse straight away from the gate. So Cup's doing that, you can tell they're getting it on, meaning they're racing fast, and obviously they couldn't sustain that kind of run, but this little filly, she is a diamond. I mean, you know, they say that girls are not supposed to compete with the boys, but I think she was an unlucky loser today.
Congratulations. Great ride out there.
Thanks.
Close enough. Thank you, Ken DeSormo, the runner-up with Honest Lady, Tom.
All right, Kenny, you see Honest Lady, one of the long shots, paying $18, $20, and $10. The winner, Kona Gold, is only the fourth winning favorite in the Breeders' Cup Sprint. Kona Gold, Honest Lady, and Bet on Sunshine, 138 on the exacta. For the presentation, here's Mike.
Thanks again, Tom. And one of the owners, Mr. Irwin Malasky, his wife and son are here to make the presentation. We've got TV and film actor Jerry O'Connell. Jerry?
All right, guys. Not only did you win the big Breeders' Cup race, but you broke a track record. So seriously, congratulations. You
and careful, it's heavy. Yes. And, I mean, Kona Gold, he's been third 2 years ago, second last year, finally gets the job done. What's it feel like, sir?
It's indescribable, and it's such an honor to be associated with an athlete like Kona Gold and an athlete like Alex Solis and my partner here, Bruce Headley, who had a game plan for this horse all year long and stuck to it, training and very few races, and he was in tip-top condition thanks to Alex Solis and Bruce Headley.
He really was in tip-top condition, and Bruce, you've done a great job with this horse, not only this year, but for the past three or four years, and today was just the crowning moment for this horse, for Kona Gold.
Well, thank you very much. But I think Kona Gold had the most to do with it.
Well, but you got to take a little bit of credit now. Keeping a horse like this together, and what did you map this out from the start of the year? The Breeders' Cup was your sole goal?
Mr. Malasky and I, we made out a plan, and we stuck to it. And he didn't argue at all, so this is what happened.
And congratulations to Alex, your first Breeders' Cup win. How's it feel?
Thank God, I got the monkey off my back finally. I had to be the most special race in my life. For the simple reason that for many years you work so hard to accomplish this kind of thing, and it goes 1, 2, 3 years, and it's second and third, and it's kind of aggravating, but at the same time, I had to teach my family, kids, never to quit, just to keep trying until you make it happen, and thank God it happened today.
And that's what Alex does, never quit, always keep trying. Back to you, Tom.
All right, Mike, let's look at the official order of finish. Kona Gold was a $35,000 Keeneland September yearling, is a 6-year-old gelding by Java Gold out of Double Sunrise by Slua Gold, bred in Kentucky by Carlos Perez. 5-star day, finishing up in that bottom spot. Well, up next, we'll go back to the grass course, and we'll give the ladies their chance. The filly and mare Turf is the next race on the Breeders' Cup card. And the opening morning line odds, Petrushka from Europe, tough number one post position, but the 5-2 morning line favorite. Touchamont at 8-1. Maltese Superb and Collect the Cash are long shots. Perfect Sting 7-2. Snow Polina 6. All the way down to Cafe Latte, who is a 10-1 shot. And while we await the horses for the Breeders' Cup filly and mare Turf, let's go back to New York and the Sun America Sports Desk and Dan Hicks.
And again, as NBC returns to Dan Hicks to update college football, we will take a commercial break. When we come back, one of the Canadian connections in this next race, we will talk with Toronto trainer David Bell. Back live at Louisville right after this.
Sometimes the greatest ideas are the simplest ones. And here's a very simple idea that will transform the way you use combination wrenches. The Mastercraft Professional Series Accelerator Wrench Set, exclusive to Canadian Tire. The open end has been redesigned to make it work like a ratchet, so you don't have to remove and reposition it after each turn. With the accelerator wrench, every job becomes quick and simple because it stays in continuous contact with a nut or bolt. You can now enjoy the benefits of a ratchet in those hard-to-reach places where sockets won't fit, and it works in both directions. Plus, it won't slip or round off nuts and bolts because its unique head design grabs the fastener, transferring power evenly to opposite sides. The accelerator wrench is up to 25% longer to give you more leverage and torque and easily break bolts loose. Its chrome nickel-plated alloy steel won't rust, and it's guaranteed forever. Complete your toolbox with a set of Mastercraft Professional Series Accelerator Wrenches, now from only $24.99. Available only at Canadian Tire.
One day, I'll have a wife and 3 kids. No, 2 kids and a dog. Well, maybe a wife. Or maybe not.
Identity crisis.
Crisis, Camry, Solera, the new Solera convertible. Three fast ways to find yourself.
Surround sound. Awaken to the new zenith, what your senses have been seeking.
Are back at Louisville, I should say, on this Saturday afternoon. The next race is the turf race for fillies and mares, several Canadian connections. Frank Stronach's got a couple of horses in this race, including Perfect Sting, who has a real shot. We'll talk with Stronach's trainer, Joe Orsino, during the next break. In this break, let's concentrate on Fly for Avi, a Toronto-based horse. She won the E.P. Taylor Stakes, and she is trained by Toronto's David Bell.
I'm hoping she'll adjust well. I mean, she doesn't take her course with her, as far as I'm concerned. She's run well at Keeneland, Gulfstream, Belmont. So she's handled different courses. She's just not run on Woodbine. She's doing the best I've ever seen her. I mean, she's just thriving. Seems to really like it in Kentucky. Coming to the Breeders' Cup, you know, with any horse is pressure, but when I was here with the favorite for the Classic, it was okay, but it's the same sort of thing with Fly for Avi. I mean, that still, you got to have confidence in your horse.
Back here at Churchill Downs, we are getting set to rejoin NBC. Quick word on the owner.
Well, this is Ivan Delos, most noted for Victory Gallop, a horse that he bred, one of the very best that won the Belmont.
And as promised, let's rejoin NBC.
The Breeders' Cup returns to Churchill Downs for a fifth time today. Wayne Lucas starts off the day in Hall of Fame style, with Long Shot Spain winning the distaff. Just 11 days ago, Sue McPeak was in the hospital for the second time in 2 months, the first time to deliver her daughter, then just weeks later to treat her cancer. Today, She's a Devil Do finished third, but the McPeaks, wife and baby, are winners. Just a few weeks, Gary Stevens returns in style with a furious rush on War Chant. And in the sprint, Kona Gold, in his third try, wins the sprint to the delight of Bruce Headley, trainer and co-owner, as he does it in track record time. Still to come, Irish-bred three-year-old filly Petrushka is the European invader and favorite to win the Filly and Mare Turf just in its second year. Has three horses in the juvenile, and he's proven his prowess at Churchill Downs with two Kentucky Derby winners. His Flamethrower is the favorite. Last year, Frankie Dettori celebrated his victory in the Breeders' Cup Turf on De Lamy in style. But just 5 months ago, the 29-year-old jockey narrowly escaped death in a plane crash. It's a minor miracle that he rides today. Champion Fusa Ichi Pegasus in the Classic. Hall of Fame trainer Neil Drysdale could cap a year of spectacular note if Fusa Ichi wins today, securing Horse of the Year honors. That's all still to come at the 17th Breeders' Cup. And the Filly and Mare Turf is next as we go back to the grass course and a full field of 14. That's the scene in the Churchill Downs paddock. As we check the current odds, Petrushka, look at this, 3-2 on the European horse. Despite that tough post, Tranquility Lake 7-1. The others, Long Shots, Perfect Sting 5-1, Snowpolina 8-1, so is Colstar, and the rest all double digits on the odds board. Let's go to Mike.
Okay, Tom Hammond, we're here with John Murtaugh, who's just making the final finishing touches on Petrushka, who's the favorite here in the Philly and Mare Turf. Once he's done tightening the girth, we might be able to get a word from him. And well, let's talk to the jockey right now. John Murtaugh, come on over here.
All right, have a good trip. Good luck.
Now, this filly, Petrushka, she's the favorite here in the Philly and Mare Turf, and Sir Michael Stout, I think I said, is the trainer of this horse, and you're the rider. She's coming into this race off three straight exceptional races. How about her chances today?
Yeah, she has a good chance. You know, she's done everything right. We're just hoping she takes the trip well and everything goes according to plan.
What kind of filly is this to ride?
She's a beautiful filly. You know, she's got no clinks in her armor. She's always there when you want her, and we're hoping for a big run.
And this filly, she's coming off of three straight wins. You had to ship her across the pond, as they say, to the United States. Any questions about her ability to handle this kind of turf course?
No.
None whatsoever.
No.
Very confident, very confident. John Murtaugh and Sir Michael Stout, the trainer of Petrushka, the favorite here in the Philly and Mare Turf, Tom.
Okay, Mike. John Murtaugh, a man of few words, but they were direct. He liked her chances. Murtaugh is quite a story in his own right. He has overcome a problem with alcohol to become one of the elite jockeys in Europe now and has won 10 Group 1 races in Europe this year.
And he's probably quite so confident because he is undefeated aboard Petrushka. The two of them have never lost a race when he's been riding her. Those last three that Mike mentioned were all with John Murtaugh aboard. We've watched this filly training this week. She might be one of the most lovely fluid movers and seems to be doing well here despite a long season and a trip across the ocean. But she will be the one they all have to catch today. The nod has to go to the Europeans, I believe, in this mile and three-eighths event.
Let's check in with Kenny Rice.
Thanks, Tom. I'm with Bob McNair. Now, football fans will know him as the man who brought the NFL back to Houston. Racing fans know him as the man who is the co-breeder of Fusaichi Pegasus. And in this Phillies and Mares turf race, he has Cafe Latte and Touche Raymond. You're a busy man these days. What about the two that you have in this race?
Well, they're both really solid fillies. Touche Raymond tends to go on the lead a little more. Cafe Latte is more of a come-from-behind filly. So I think we'll have an honest pace. I don't think anybody will win it with an easy lead.
Well, good luck to you, Bob.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Thank you very much. Bob McNair with two in this race. Now let's go over to Bob Neumeier.
One of the real movers and shakers in our game, Frank Stronach. He's sending out a pair here in Perfect Sting and Collect the Cash. Look, put your owner hat on, first of all, and tell us about Perfect Sting. She seems to be the best of the pair.
I guess first you have to sing, and then you can collect the cash.
Good answer.
Okay.
Frank, you've shaken up the landscape of the racing world. Your tracks have broken away from the NTRA. I wonder if you could just make a comment about that and the future of this sport as you see it.
No, I don't think we shake up the world. I think we just want to make a constructive contribution, right? It's simple. I think we have last year, about the same time of the year, we had a simple request. We said, I believe in a national organization, but that organization has to define. And we had three requests, right? That the board should be elected by its stakeholders in a democratic vote, right, on democratic principles. Second, I said, the mandate has to be defined, what they should do. And thirdly, commitment to free enterprise, because that's what America's all about.
He's taken over many of the racetracks of America. He's a maverick. He's Frank Stronach. Tom, back to you.
Okay.
All right, Bob Neumeier, as we check the current odds, Petrushka 7-5, 7-1 on Tranquility Lake. Perfect Sting's at 5-1, Snowpolina 8-1, Colstar at 9-1, Catella 13, and Cafe Latte at 16-1. Well, Frank Stronach has shaken up the racing world. He owns Santa Anita, Gulfstream, and other tracks, and the NTRA and the Breeders' Cup have merged now, and the fact that Stronach says his tracks may not participate anymore would be quite a blow to them. It also may cost Santa Anita a chance to host the Breeders' Cup in 2002, as the NTRA created to, among other things, promote the sport and has had the endorsement of most all in racing. But Stronach has been a maverick and is at least threatening to pull out his tracks and has announced he will pull out his tracks, and some in the Mid-Atlantic region also saying they will leave. Horses on the track for the fillies and mares Turk Petrushka, supplemented for $90,000 by High Clare, founded by Harry Herbert, son of the Queen's racing manager, and trained by Sir Michael Stout, who just wrapped up his sixth British training title. Number two, Tout Charmant. Trainer Ron McAnally knows his way to the Breeders' Cup winner's circle. He's won four times. Pulled the upset of Perfect Sting with this filly's last race at Keeneland. Number three, Maltese Superb. Yukata Taki has been champion Japanese jockey 10 times earlier this year. Moved his tack to Southern California, where he plans to ride for a couple of years. But he's on a real outsider with this Japanese-trained filly. Number four, Collect the Cash, did in Keeneland's Grade 1 Queen Elizabeth Challenge Cup at 25-1, her fourth straight win. And by the way, a new Kentucky racing rule eliminates entries in million-dollar races, or Collect the Cash would be coupled with Perfect Sting. This filly ensures an honest pace for her stablemate. The five is Tranquility Lake. Mr. and Mrs. Marty Wygod, the owners, have a Tranquility Lake on their California property. However, things were anything but tranquil for this filly earlier this year when a spider bite put her out of action for a while. A front runner, she's won all three starts this year. Number six, Goldamix, a three-year-old filly who also has only three races this year in France and has yet to win. This filly's owners, the Wertheimer brothers, own the 93 Breeders' Cup turf winner, Cotichon. Number seven is Fly for Avi, a Canadian-trained mare who's right at home as the distances stretch out. Comes off a nose victory after a troubled trip in Woodbine's Grade 1 E.P. Taylor Stakes. Number eight is Perfect Sting, owned by Frank Stronach, who's awesome again, won the Classic here 2 years ago. This filly has had five starts this year and lost only once, her last out at Keeneland. Number nine, Snow Polina, ridden by the leading Breeders' Cup jockey, Pat Day. Gary Tanaka purchased this mare last year, brought her from Europe to the U.S. Her biggest win came in the Beverly D at Arlington. She's one of the few who have won at this mile and three-eighths distance. Number 10, Colstar, owned by Beverly Steinman, a newspaper publisher from Lancaster, Pennsylvania. After losing two straight to Perfect Sting, she ran the biggest race of her life to win Belmont's Flower Bowl Handicap. Number 11 is Spanish Fur in the Judmont Franco connection. This mare has been chasing Perfect Sting and Tranquility Lake all season. Comes off a second in the yellow ribbon. Number 12, Pico Tenerife, named for a landmark on Barbados, where owner Eugene Melnick lives. Her only win of the year back in February. 13, Catella, German-owned and bred mare, who's been very competitive in European Group 1s, often facing the males. And in six races at this distance, she has three wins and 2 seconds. And number 14, Cafe Latte, who may need a shot of caffeine from that outside post. Baffert-trained mare's been running with the best in California with mixed success. Three wins, but comes off a fifth in the yellow ribbon. And you can get comprehensive coverage of the Breeders' Cup by logging on to MSNBCSports.com. Take part in our online cyber capping. Match your picks against those of Mike and Bob. That's all at MSNBCSports.com, official website of NBC Sports. And to see how they view the filly and mare turf, let's go to Mike and Bob.
Thanks, Tom. You know, I'm due for a win. I need me a win here sooner or later. But, you know, international racing is part of what makes the Breeders' Cup great. This is truly an international field. We've got horses from the United States, from Canada, from France, from Great Britain, from Germany, from Japan. Who do you like?
I'm going to stay back home with this one. We interviewed Frank Stronach, and I happen to like his Perfect Sting in this race. She has been a model of consistency. Ridden by Jerry Bailey, she has won four of her last five, six of her last eight, and nine of her last 12. The distance of a mile and three-eighths is an issue. Yeah. I think she can get that distance, and I like her at a square price today, Michael.
You know, I really think that the distance is an issue in this race. There's a lot of these fillies and mares that haven't proven they can get the distance. Petrushka has already proven that she can handle a distance of ground. There's a shot of Petrushka. She's won her last three starts at a mile and a half or more, and she will be flying at the end. Look at the way she's won these last three races. The Irish Oaks drawing away the Yorkshire Oaks at a mile and a half, and the Prix de l'Opera at a mile and a quarter, so she can definitely get it. This is Petrushka on the outside. She'll just be coming into your picture here. The dark blue cap you see under the arrow, and look at the closing kick that Petrushka shows in this race going a mile and a half. You don't see a lot of horses finish up this well going a mile and a half. Petrushka did it last time out. If she shows that same kind of run over the Churchill Downs turf course, I think she's going to get the job done, and I need her to get home from here to be a winner here.
It's an electrifying turn of foot that she has, but you have others here as well. Tranquility Lake. You have two Charmant, and even this one, Snow Polina.
You know, Snow Polina, I think, is a logical long shot in here. Pat Day is aboard. She's got tactical speed. I think she'll be one of the pace setters. I don't think she'll be on the lead. I think she'll be pressing the pace. She won a 1 3/8 a couple of years ago back in France, and I think she's got a pretty good shot at 9 or 10 to 1.
And if you're looking for sleepers, and that really is the order of the day, why not Catella? 30 to 1 morning line. She's been bet down to 14 to 1. Now, this is a filly that has run primarily in Germany, but against solid male competition. And transferring her form to this race makes her a live contender in this filly and mare turf. But this is a balanced field. It's a tactical race. It's a rider's race. I think it's a fascinating event.
I do too, but I'm looking for Petrushka in here. Tom?
All right, this is a tough one, guys. We've had two long shots and two favorites win at the Breeders' Cup so far. What will happen in the mile? We'll find out when we return to Churchill Downs.
Up next, it is the turf race for fillies and mares. During the last break, we focused on Fly for AV, Toronto-based. As you just heard, Frank Stronach has two horses, one a speedster, Collect the Cash, the other Perfect Sting with a real shot. Now, we talked with Stronach's trainer, Joe Orsino, here at Churchill this week. Wondered about pressure, because remember, the last time the Breeders was here, Stronach won the Classic with Awesome Again. What about the pressure?
To win one of these in a lifetime, you know, might be something that nobody ever does, and come back and win back-to-back at Churchill, you know, Classic, or even if we, you know, should win the Juvenile or the Filly and Mare Turf. I mean, I think it would be a great accomplishment. It says a lot for our program, too.
It is a strong program indeed. All right, Collect the Cash is a speedster. Perfect Sting has a real shot, and it has truly been a remarkable year for Frank Stronach's Perfect Sting.
She's been a highlight all year, you know, just from her first race back to backing up to a mile to winning the Diana at Saratoga. That was something we all wanted to do. And, you know, the only blemish was her last race at Keeneland. And take circumstances, you know, into it and the whole equation of it was a good horse that beat her and a good rider. And, you know, they may have outsmarted us that day. But luckily, you know, you learn when you lose. And I think we learned enough out of that race to maybe win the Breeders' Cup. So if that helped us win it, then, you know, there's no sad point to that.
Perfect Sting in the turf race, fillies and mares. How about your picks?
Well, I think she has a very good chance, but Petrushka, who is coming in off a win in the Prix de l'Opera, have to give her top ranking. Petrushka has trained very well this week at Churchill. Perfect Sting has trained extremely well. And for a long shot, how about on the home side, Fly for Avi? We also have Pico Tenerife from Woodbine in here. A couple of years ago, she was winning at Woodbine, and she goes for Eugene Melnick, who is a real emerging force in this game.
And again, Fly for Avi, Toronto-based and trained by David Bell. But I think the horse with the Canadian connections with the best chance is Perfect Sting, sent out by Frank Stronach. The turf race for fillies and mares. Let's go back to NBC.
We're just about ready for the Breeders' Cup Filly and Mare Turf. They're loading into the gate. 7-5 on Petrushka as the favorite. The five-horse Tranquility Lake at 7-1. And it's a 1 3/8, which means a short run to that first turn. Another complete circuit and around to the finish line, 1 3/8 on the Matt Wynn turf course here at Churchill Downs. That's Fly for Avi standing behind the gate, soaring softly, of course, the Breeders' Cup record, because that was the first filly and mare turf run just last year. Donna Brothers, how do things look behind the starting gate?
Well, right now, Pico Tenerife is acting up a little bit in the gate. That's the holdup. They've got her settled down now, it looks like they'll continue to load from here.
And there's Catella, the German mare, balking big time.
Yeah, Catella, when she first walked up to the gate, sucked back like that, but now it looks like they're going to try to get a running start to load.
Kit DeSarmo gave her an old-fashioned Cajun nudge in the ribs there.
She needed it. She might need more than that, though. Kit DeSarmo might have to go to the whip before the race. All the other horses are standing in the gate beautifully. They're all handling those very well. Hopefully they'll be able to get Catella into the gate in good order.
Nope, she says no. Well, easing up toward the gate. Let's go to Tom Durkin for the call.
And two horses remaining behind the gate now.
pulled up and pulled out of the race. Spanish Fern has been pulled up. Victor Espinosa dismounts. In the meantime, the rest of the field continues on their way, and it is Maltese Superb who is out to establish the early pace, followed by Collect the Cash, who will be the prompter as they come into the stretch for the first time. Tushaman hugs the hedge in third position. Tranquility Lake is just off the pace today. She's running in fourth. The Gray Golden Mix is fifth. The favorite, Petrushka, a ground-saving sixth. She's got a good spot in the early going. Snow Polina is now seventh, followed by Perfect Sting. Running in mid-pack, she's eighth. Pico Tenerife in the clear ninth, followed by Cold Star, the German filly Catella, and at the back of the pack, Fly for AV and stretch running Cafe Latte. It's a sensible pace here, established by the Japanese filly Maltese Superb. The first quarter at 24 and change and a half goes in 48 and 2/5 seconds. The field rounding the clubhouse turn now. Maltese Superb and Yutakataki. The leader's down. Here's Collect the Cash to confront her as they move into the backstretch. Collect the Cash now makes a move with 5 furlongs remaining here. The leader now in front by a head. The early leader Maltese Superb is back in second. Tranquility Lake cruising along in third. Tushaman is moving very comfortably, drafting in behind the leaders fourth as they approach the half-mile pole now. There goes Snow Polina making her move. Snow Polina moves up to be fifth. Golden Mix is now sixth. Petrushka is in behind horses. She's seventh, but she's only 4 lengths from the lead. And Perfect Sting is launching her bid as the field moves into the far turn. Now Perfect Sting is picking off horses one by one as they round the far turn. Tranquility Lake has come away with the lead. Snow Polina is right there. Collect the Cash. Perfect Sting on the outside. Tushaman's in behind the lead. Golden Mix. Petrushka's got a lot to do. She's still 6 lengths behind as the field comes to the top of the stretch. And Cold Star is uncorking her rally. And the German filly, Catella, isn't with a chance. And they're coming into the final furlong now. And on the outside of it, Perfect Sting. Perfect Sting has come away with the lead. Tushaman is full out and driving second. Snow Polina toward the rail. Catella coming down to the final 16th. It is Perfect Sting clinging desperately to the lead. Tushaman, second best to Perfect Sting, the winner. Perfect Sting wins by length. Tushaman finishing second, and Catella was third. Well, Jerry Bailey biding his time in the early stages of this race with Perfect Sting launching a bit as they moved into the far turn. Got up to win it in 2 minutes and 13 seconds flat. And that equals the course record here at Churchill Downs, Tom Hammond.
All right, Tom, equaling the course record, Perfect Sting. The last race at Keeneland, there raised some doubts about her because it was the first time she had tasted defeat in 5 starts this year. But she settled all those doubts today with a victory here in the filly and mare turf in the Stronach Stable colors, trained by Joe Orsino, ridden to victory by Jerry Bailey. And let's see if Donna has caught up to him. Donna?
Jerry Bailey, it looked like you came from a little further off the pace today. Congratulations for one. Tell me about her race and how she redeemed herself today.
Thanks, Donna. It was a little more speed than I anticipated. Thus, as you say, I was a little further back. I didn't know she could go 1 3/8 as effectively as she could 1 1/4, 1 1/8, but she sure proved it.
Congratulations. Back to you, Tom. Beautiful performance, and she redeems herself after the Tushaman defeat last time.
All right, Donna. Jerry Bailey recording his 10th Breeders' Cup victory. Perfect Sting measured the early leaders and then holding off to Tushaman again, reversing the order of finish in their last race at Keeneland. Perfect Sting on her way to the Turf Mare Championship with a victory here in the Philly and Mare Turf, as Tushaman and Chris McCarron on her flank, but Perfect Sting digs in and holds on for the victory. Joe Orsino with the victory as he sees Perfect Sting. The flowers are taking the worst of it. And there she is. Perfect Sting has the win.
There are over 800,000 job openings
for internet specialists right now.
3 million more in the next 5 years.
By the time I'm 18.
By the time I'm 18, over 1 billion jobs will require internet skills.
Are you ready?
Are you ready?
Virtually all internet traffic travels across the systems of one company, the same one sponsoring thousands of networking academies. Cisco Systems, empowering the internet generation.
We ready?
Are you?
If you could imagine a bagless vacuum that outcleans all other bagless brands, it would look like this. Introducing the revolutionary Hoover Bagless. Featuring our advanced twin chamber system for better cleaning power. It's everything you imagined a bagless vacuum, what, could be. The new Hoover Bagless, because deep down, you want Hoover.
Each year, thousands of people in Ontario get the flu.
When you get the flu, you can expect to be sick for a few days, even wind up in the hospital.
When you get the flu, you can expect to miss some days of work.
By not getting your flu shot, you can give the flu to someone else too.
Perhaps someone at risk who could wind up in the hospital with serious complications.
And flu shots are free to everyone in Ontario. Protect yourself.
Protect your family.
Get the flu shot.
You know, people can be so cruel. I got feelings like everybody else. So what if I can't hook up a stereo? Or I don't know the difference between high fidelity and digital cinema sound? Does that make me inferior? Door analog! I'm gonna beat him at their own game. I don't know how, but I'll find a way.
Well, the season's just about over for the Argonauts. They will wrap it up tomorrow against the Eastern Conference champion Alouettes. That's at 1 Eastern, 10 Pacific.
Perfect Sting and Jerry Bailey after a win in the Philly and Mare turf. Perfect Sting had run 6 the last year. She gives Joe Orsino, the trainer, his first Breeders' Cup win, number 10 for Jerry Bailey. 4-year-old filly by Red Radinsome, from Valid Victors by Valid Appeal. Bred in Kentucky by Adina Springs. Let's go to Trevor.
Well, quite an eventful race here, Tom. Let's take a look at the number 11 horse. First of all, this is her right here, Spanish Fern. A few jumps out of the gate, and Victor Espinosa just pulls her up. She must have taken a bad step. It doesn't look to be too severe, but obviously Victor feels something right there. She's hardly even come out the gate. She seems to be hanging her left back leg a little there, and possibly that's what the problem is. You see, she's not putting any weight on that left hind leg, so we have to presume it's something there. Hopefully it's not too bad. It probably didn't look too bad either. Evidently, Bob has a report on Spanish Fern, so let's take it back down to Bob.
Well, I talked to the rider of Spanish Fern, Victor Espinosa, and Victor said that the horse was so eager to break that she zoomed out of the gate, and then he heard a kind of a crack in the back, and so precautionary measures, he immediately pulled her up and got off Spanish Fern. I was listening to the explanation of Bobby Frankel and the owner. They were obviously very distressed about the situation, but the rider heard a crack in the back, and that's why he dismounted and walked off.
And Bob, the word is that Spanish Fern injured her left hind leg at the start of the race. She has been taken for x-rays. Kenny Rice.
I'm with Chris McCarron, who comes in second with Two Charmant. She ran a nice race for you, Chris. Maybe get into it a little earlier would have been a nicer situation to set up in this record time victory.
Without question, Kenny. I think the difference of the end result was the winner got the jump on us around the turn. I had to sit and wait for some room to go. I was tucked behind Tranquility Lake, who I thought was one of the fillies to beat. And Snow Polina reins up on the outside of the half-mile pole, kept me from getting out. Then here came Perfect Sting at the 3/8 pole, kept me from getting out. And Jerry obviously had his filly in perfect position and got the jump on us. I thought we were going to get it right here.
Yeah, you're almost right there.
Yards, yeah. But Perfect Sting's a fighter. I tell you what, she loves a battle, and she wins most of them.
You said Two Charmant has run well for you on every surface. She was coming in here off a win at Keeneland and had run well for you out west.
That's true. I rode her at Del Mar. She, deep grass, she loved it. Hollywood firm grass, she loved it. And Keeneland sandy grass, she loved it. So, again, she ran well again. So, she's a great filly.
All right. Thanks very much, Chris. Chris McCarron aboard Two Charmant, who comes in second here to Perfect Sting in the Fillies and Mares turf, Tom.
And there is a Perfect Sting. My friend J.B. Faulkner, who writes the books The Names They Give Them, says that she's by Red Ransom. Ransom suggests a crime. To a lesser degree, so does a sting operation. So Perfect Sting pays $12, $6.20, and $4.60. Two Charmant second. Catella, the German mayor, was third. Mike?
Thanks, Tom. And the winning connections here, Mr. Frank Stronach, Joe Orsino, and Jerry Bailey. A Perfect Sting, just a perfect ride and a perfect race turned in by Perfect Sting. To make the presentation, we have Dan Stone, the Vice President of Corporate Communications of Alberto Culver.
Thank you. The team that makes and markets Alberto Culver hair care products, St. Ives and Tresemme, congratulates the team that brought Perfect Sting home. Great race.
Thank you very much.
Mr. Stronach, tell us a little bit about this win. What does it mean to you?
Well, I guess as the name says, a perfect sting. It's just the right name for that filly. I think with that win today, she should be the champion turf mare in America this year.
How about the job Joe Orsino did as your trainer? What a job having this horse ready. Just a great campaign all year long. She's run, what, six times now, five wins in a second, and just a beautiful job of training.
Thank you, Mike. I really appreciate it. She's a lovely filly to train, and, you know, Mr. Stronach gave me the tools, and all we did was manage her properly.
There was a little bit of a question about the distance because she had never been that far. Did that worry you at all?
No, I wasn't concerned at all. Not with Jerry. I mean, he knows the filly. He knew how to get her to the winner's circle first, so he did a great job riding her today.
And speaking of Jerry Bailey, as usual, he gets that good trip. Jerry, you were a little bit further back off the pace than this mare normally is.
Well, with the extra furlong from, you know, I didn't know how effective she was going to be going mile three, so I was going to be conservative in the beginning. And when I thought she had enough to get us to the wire, I went ahead and cut her loose.
And you had the perfect trip, no problems along the way.
She likes to win, and she's got a lot of ones by her name for a reason.
You know they were coming at you a little bit at the end, though.
Yeah, but every time they got to her hip, she'd give me a little bit more, so I was really never concerned.
Great job. Thank you, Jerry. Joe, good job. Mr. Stronach,
okay,
congratulations.
Okay.
Tom?
All right, Mike, here's the official order of finish then in the filly and mare turf. Perfect sting to Charmant Catella. Petrushka the favorite, finishing in fifth place. Tranquility Lake was eighth. And, of course, Spanish Fern was pulled up shortly after the start. Well, coming up next is the Breeders' Cup Juvenile as we see the two-year-old Colts and Geldings and get an early line on the Kentucky Derby of next year. There's a look at the morning line odds now. Let's see, might have changed actually to the latest odds. That's AP Valentine, the six horse, who now has been bet down to 8-5. So AP Valentine, the Nick Zito trainee, is at 8-5, as you see some of the others. The four-horse Macho Uno is at 9-2. And number 9, Street Cry, at 6-1. This is really a quality field of two-year-old Colts and Geldings. Top to bottom with quality depth. All right, we are back for the Breeders' Cup Juvenile as we continue on Breeders' Cup Day.
Enjoy a slice and medium coffee for just $2.29.
The new 250 horsepower Pathfinder.
In motion, no barriers nor bounds restrict these athletes. Gathering momentum, aimed at glory, the spotlight shines on the Paralympics beginning November 11th on CBC.
Inspires at Churchill Downs on Breeders' Cup Day in Louisville, Kentucky. Overcast, but a very pleasant afternoon. And we have seen some shocking results. We open the day with a couple of upsets. We've seen some favorites win. It has been a day of high sport with one course record equaled and one 6-furlong track record set here at Churchill Downs. And next up is the Breeders' Cup Juvenile. You know, one of the charming aspects of racing is that it's all an inexact science. Has anyone figured out how to get your hands on a good two-year-old?
I think this Breeders' Cup Juvenile Colt is like the beginning of our big dream for the Kentucky Derby.
It's going to be a big field with 14 horses.
This one's trained by this one. This one's owned by this one.
We're going to see a lot of stars come out of this.
It's sort of like a mini derby, and it takes a special horse.
What does it take to be a juvenile champion, a derby favorite? Do you need a big-name trainer like Bob Baffert or Wayne Lucas?
I'd love to beat those two guys. I mean, that would be great. And let's not forget Godolphin. You know, I look at their horses. I mean, my God, they're beautiful horses.
Godolphin Stable will send out Street Cry, trained by Owen Hardy, who for years worked for Bob Baffert.
I think he called me because he probably couldn't get Bob. So he figured I'd been there for 7 years and possibly knew some of the secrets, so he took a shot with me.
Maybe it's not just the trainer. Perhaps cash is a factor. Baffert's flamethrower cost $270,000. Nick Zito's AP Valentine almost $500,000. Lucas's Yanaguska nearly $2 million. And then there's City Zip, trained by Linda Rice and bought for $9,000. Just $9,000.
I handle what I'm, you know, dealt. I've had some meagerly placed young horses, been good athletes, gone on and had quite a bit of success with them.
They don't have to be royally bred or expensive. They can excel at a two-year-old.
Really, what you pay for them is doesn't really mean that much once they run.
This is the toughest game played outdoors. They have no favorites. You can't corner the market.
When you see a horse like City Zip, which was purchased for $9,000 and is here at the Breeders' Cup today, it gives everyone the idea that they themselves may race in the Breeders' Cup one day. They may have that good fortune. And it's not just a sport of kings. It's a land of opportunity.
And it might be an opportunity to make a little cash through the betting windows today, because it is a very well-matched field. You can make a good case for several of the two-year-olds in the Breeders' Cup Juvenile. Let's check the odds. Point given 10-1. Scorpion is at 30. Dollar Bill 25. Macho Uno 5-1. Novaire 35. AP Valentine 9-5 favorite. Turnberry Isle 45-1. City Zip 35-1 on the $9,000 yearling purchase. Street Cry 6-1. Arabian Light 12. Yanaguska 11. Flamethrower Surprise at 7-1. He's unbeaten. Many thought he would be the favorite, trained by Baffert. Trail the Fox 70. Burning Roma 40-1. Really a surprise to see a flamethrower at 7-1. Bob?
For those of you that like to play the stock market, this is a story that might interest you. We're looking at AP Valentine, trained by Nick Zito, owned by Celtics basketball coach Rick Pitino and his friends. Nick Zito thought the world of the Triple Crown prospects were passing him by, so he said, I'm going to buy a horse myself. He went to the yearling sale at Saratoga, Pitino at his side, and purchased this great-looking son of AP Indy for $475,000. Shazam. But a year and a half later, he enters him in the Champagne Stakes after an impressive maiden win. He goes off as one of the favorites, and this horse ran a smashing race that day. Very impressive. George Chavez ducking in on the inside, finding a narrow seam, and working his way on to one of the more impressive two-year-old wins we've ever seen. That's why this horse is one of the favorites today. Now, Coolmore Stud decided that they were going to get in this game as well. And with me is John Magnier, who is in charge of this operation, and he decided that it might not be a bad idea to buy the breeding rights. For how much, John?
Well, you'll have to ask Mr. Pitino that.
I heard it was $15 million. And this is like the stock market, right? You think so much of this horse that if you wait too long and he wins the Derby, now you're in a Fusici Pegasus situation, and it might be $50 or $60 million. Am I on to something?
But it doesn't always work out that way. For every winner, there's a loser, so we're just hoping. We saw the horse in Saratoga, and we liked him a lot. He's got a good pedigree, and we like the trainer very much. We've had success with him before. He's by AP Indy, which we think might be a sire of sires. He's won a Group 1 race as a two-year-old, which is unusual for an AP Indy. So we thought, you know, with the price of yearlings and whatever have you, that it was a good bet.
This is gambling in its highest order, isn't it? This is the top of the game of gambling.
Well, the way we look at it, it's a calculated risk. You win some and lose some. And unless we win the odd one, we're not going to keep at it. So, fingers crossed.
Thank you, John. Let's go to Mike Battaglia.
And, Bob, if these two-year-olds can run half as fast as Bob Baffert, they can all run, because he started off with Point Given. He ran down. He saddled Arabian Light. Then he got here, and he saddled Flamethrower. You got to be out of breath, Bob.
It's a record. Did you put the clock on me?
Have you ever done that before?
Yeah, about five of them. No, never in the Breeders' Cup.
You got to do it.
It's easy. Once you got it down, I have good assistance and everything else, and the valets are very good today, so they're waiting for me, so no problem.
All right, great job, Bob.
I just hope they run as fast as I saddle them.
I do too, Bob. All right, Tom.
9 minutes to post as Bob Baffert's playing his hand, three of a kind in the Breeders' Cup Juvenile.
Because let's face it, you got way better stuff to do.
Your call will be answered by the next available operator. Please stand by.
Your service reps are overwhelmed with customer calls, faxes, and emails. Integrate the internet into your call center and go from providing customer support to creating customer delight. Discover all that's possible on the internet. Cisco Systems, empowering the internet generation.
Savor another vintage year. Call for your guide.
Issues in the federal election campaign. Join Peter Mansbridge and news anchors from across the country. Sunday on CBC. Check local listings.
14 two-year-old colts and geldings have made their appearance on the Churchill Downs Oval in preparation for the Breeders' Cup Juvenile. The purse $1,070,000. They'll be going a mile and a 16th. And all the trainers we have spoken with have said that they are impressed with this crop of two-year-olds. Perhaps something special when we come back to Churchill Downs for the Kentucky Derby. First time on NBC, first Saturday in May. The six-horse, AP Valentine, still the favorite, but's gone up a bit now at 2-1. And at 5-1 is Macho Uno. Number one is Point Given. One-third of Baffert's strong hand, ridden for the first time by Stevens. Baffert not pleased with Kent DeSormo's ride in the Champagne, wanting him further off the pace. This colt winner of Turfway's Kentucky Cup Juvenile. Number two, Scorpion, a Seattle Slough colt who sold for nearly $500,000 at Keeneland. Trained by Lucas, he has only a maiden win, ninth in the Champagne. Number three, Dollar Bill, former Lucas assistant Dallas Stewart, conditions this colt, who's raced only three times, was second to Arabian Light in the Lanes End Breeders' Futurity at this distance. Number four, Macho Uno, Frank Stronach, as a real runner here, looking for his second Breeders' Cup win today. Only three starts, but a maiden win, a narrow defeat in the hopeful, and a romp in Canada's Grey Stakes around two turns. He's a half-brother to the 98 Classic winner, Awesome Again. Number five, Novaire, also a half-brother to a Breeders' Cup star, to champion Arazi, who made that unbelievable move to win the 91 Juvenile here at the Downs. This colt, named for a French ballet dancer, has won four of six, all on the grass in Europe. Number six is AP Valentine, Rick Pitino's Celtic Pride stable. That $15 million breeding rights sale to the Kumaroa Group. Son of AP Indy, and gave Nick Zito his third straight Champagne with a big move along the rail. Number seven, Turnberry Isle, owned by the Coolmore crew, trained by 31-year-old Irishman Aidan O'Brien. Racing on the grass in Europe, he has won three of four. Eight is City Zip, the most accomplished two-year-old in the East after sweeping Saratoga's juvenile graded stakes. Trainer Linda Rice plans to let him once again use his natural speed after a seventh, trying to rate in the Champagne. By the way, we talked about him costing $9,000. He's earned over $400,000. Number nine, Street Cry, Godolphin-owned colt, trained by the former Baffert assistant Hardy. Loser to Flamethrower by a head and a neck his last two starts. Number 10, Arabian Light, from the Thoroughbred Corporation, trained by Baffert, ridden by Shane Sellers, who guided him to a three-length win in the Breeders' Futurity, doing it with a sweeping move that evoked images of Arazi. Number 11, Yanaguska, sired by Cherokee Run and named for a Cherokee Indian chief. Lucas paid nearly $2 million for him at the Fasig Tipton two-year-old sale this year. Dead heated with City Zip from the hopeful before finishing third in the Champagne. 12 is Flamethrower, who has been hotter than a flamethrower for Baffert. Never headed, getting faster every race. Espinoza was up when he out. He's raced at six different tracks. Biggest win, the Arlington Washington Futurity. He was claimed for $50,000 in July and has earned $250,000. And 14 is Burning Roma. Chris McCarron looking for his eighth Breeders' Cup win on this long shot, based in Maryland. Fourth, the Breeders' Futurity in his last start. That's the field of 14, and to analyze them, Bob and Mike.
Well, perhaps you've heard about the jinx. No horse has won both the Breeders' Cup Juvenile and the Kentucky Derby. But, Mike, the dreams live on.
That's right. And you know what? There's a horse in here by AP Indy called AP Valentine that Nick Zito, I've never heard Nick. He's high on a lot of his horses, but I've never heard him so high on horse. Look at the move AP Valentine makes here in the Champagne. That's him on the inside, coming through a narrow opening, coming from off the pace and really finishing up strong. His first try at a mile and a 16th. He showed that he can handle the distance. This son of AP Indy figures to improve with racing. And I really think the pace is going to be quick here this afternoon. I think the race is going to set up for another one of those late runs.
This is a brilliant field. We have two horses from the West Coast that I think are scintillating. One of them is Street Cry and the other one is Flamethrower. And there he is, the unusual flaxen mane. Boy, he reminds me of the old hockey player, the Golden Jet, Bobby Hull, with those blonde curls bouncing around. And here is a wonderfully run race involving the two horses that I spoke of. Street Cry trying to get by Flamethrower, but he's so game on the front end. This was a very, very good race. Either of those two could certainly win today. I lean towards Flamethrower because of that natural speed. The outside post is a disadvantage, no doubt. But Bob Baffert's got an embarrassment of riches here with three solid entries.
Well, you take the West Coast, I'll take the East Coast. Not only do I like AP Valentine to win, I like the horse that ran second AP Valentine, Point Given, and there's a shot of Point Given. This is a huge Son of Thunder Gulch, and I really have been impressed with the way this horse ran, starting in the Kentucky Cup at Turfway Park. He circled horses, and I really like the way he finished up, so I like the exacta in here, the AP Valentine, Point Given exacta, Tom.
All right, Mike, and favorites have usually done pretty well in this race. AP Valentine, the Cyber Cappers like as well, 33%. Flamethrower at 17, and Arabian Light is the 8% choice of the Cyber Cappers. And as they warm up, let's check the current odds for this field. Point Given 9-1. Macho Uno 5-1. AP Valentine is 2-1 in the favorites. City Zip 35-1, Street Cry at 5, Arabian Light 10, Yanaguska 11, Flamethrower 6-1, Trail the Fox 70, and Burning Roma 35-1 shot. Well, there's the favorite, AP Valentine. Could he get a leg up and become the Derby favorite? Maybe be back here first Saturday in May. We'll be back.
As NBC takes a commercial break, we will remain live here at Churchill Downs in Louisville. Frank Stronach already with one win here this afternoon. Perfect Sting in the turf race for fillies and mares. He's got a real shot with Macho Uno here in this juvenile race. However, trainer Joe Orsino cautions Macho Uno is still maturing.
He's growing up. He's not where I'd want him to be if he was going to run in the Derby next week, but that's not next week, so we have time for that. He's where he should be at this stage of his career. He's still a two-year-old that likes to play. You can hear him in the background. He's got a lot of play on his mind. He's just a big kid, but he's getting there. The race in Canada helped him a lot.
All right, let's revisit that point about why race a two-year-old now and the connection between the juvenile here and the Kentucky Derby.
Well, this is a very grueling development for these horses to get to this point in this big race. And what happens in this situation is that if horses run too tough a race, they won't be around for next spring. Who could forget a Rossi and what a great race he ran here? He wasn't around to run big as a three-year-old. And Anise last year, he looked great and he didn't even make it to the Kentucky Derby. So you have to spare your horse at this time of year. Macho Uno doesn't have the physical and mental development of many of the other peers that he's running against today, so it's a challenge for him.
All right, it is a challenge for Macho Uno, again trained by Joe Orsino, owned by Frank Stronach, who's at war with the people that own Churchill Downs. Let's have a look at your picks for this juvenile race.
Well, I thought AP Indy had a very good chance, AP Valentine rather, by AP Indy, and Street Cry, a horse coming out of California, has impressed me so much this week. Point Given, a horse that ran well against AP Valentine. Valentine last time in New York. I have to give him a big chance to be there as well.
Very quickly, what about Macho Uno? When we arrived here earlier this week, you were very high on Macho Uno.
Yes, he's a horse that is coming up to a good race, but boy, he is immature.
All right, he is immature indeed. It's the juvenile race coming up. Following that, we still have a couple of huge, huge races, the turf race, and of course the classic. Frank Stronach will send out Golden Missile in the classic as he tries to derail Fusa Ichi Pegasus. He did it before with Red Bullet in the Preakness. Right now, as promised, it's the juvenile, and back once again to NBC.
Back at Churchill Downs, there's Flamethrower, 5-1 in the juvenile. His owner, Gary Garber, is with Kenny Rice. Kenny?
Thanks, Tom. Gary Garber has his lucky Hawaiian shirt on. Why the Hawaiian shirt?
The horse has been running down at Del Mar. Usually, you know, it's very casual down there. This is probably the most dressed I've ever been for a horse race. I started winning the horse when he ran in the Best Pal, and I wore it in those last three stakes races, and there's no, just going to continue to wear it.
For a bonus, I know you got a horseshoe necklace on there, too.
We got a horseshoe necklace my wife gave me several years ago. It never comes off. And hope it's a good race. Everyone comes back safe. And hopefully we'll see everyone in May.
All right. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Good luck, Gary. Back to you, Tom.
All right, Kenny, as they load in for the juvenile. Now over a mile and a 16th. Let's go to Tom Durkin for the call.
Well, on the first Saturday in May, they'll place this starting gate a little bit up the track here at Churchill Downs for the running of the Kentucky Derby. And this race will go a long way in determining who will be the early favorite for next year's Run for the Roses. The favorite right now is AP Valentine at 2-1. As Burning Roma is the 14th two-year-old to enter the starting gate, walking just a bit in behind the starting gate. Chris McCarron aboard Burning Roma. Expected early speed here. Flamethrower and Trail the Fox. Good speed from them. They are in the gate. Ready for the start. And they're off. City Zip, and he's got some zip today. City Zip is heading for the lead. Scorpion down toward the inside. On the outside, Arabian Light is showing speed today. And Flamethrower is third as they hit the clubhouse turn. City Zip and Arabian Light going at it early. Arabian Light up for the lead. Flamethrower right there, third on the outside. Macho Uno runs in fourth. Yanaguska, fifth and on the move on the outside. Nobert moves to sixth. And Scorpion has been shuffled back to seventh. AP Valentine is headstrong. He's moving early. Moving from eighth position with six furlongs to go. Street Cry is now running in ninth. Then a break of three back to Trail the Fox, who's got no speed today. Then Point Given laboring down toward the inside. Turnberry Isle at the back of the pack with Donnerbill. Burning Roma is 14th. The quarter goes in 23 2/5 seconds to half in 46-4. The fractions are honest. And the leader into the far turn is Arabian Light. Flamethrower right there with them. Yanaguska poised and Yanaguska on the move. Macho Uno right there in a crowd of horses. City of Zip toward the inside is now coming on. AP Valentine has made steady progress in the field. Five lengths for the lead with less than three furlongs to go. Street Cry is beginning to pick it up as the field approaches the quarter pole. Scorpion down toward the inside and he's caught in traffic as the field turns for home with Arabian Light, and he comes roaring off the turn to lead the field by two lengths. Street Cry is coming on through between horses. Macho Uno still with some fight. City Zip fights on gamely toward the inside. Burning Roma coming with his late run from the back of the pack. Point Given. Here's Macho Uno. Macho Uno coming on to take the lead as Point Given flies at him. Macho Uno veers up and finishes in a photo with the oncoming Point Given. By the back, it is close for third there between Street Cry and Burning Roma. Well, they're coming down the stretch, and Macho Uno kind of veered out there right toward the end as Point Given, who was coming from off the pace, finishes with him. I'm not sure who got it, Tom Hammond.
I'm not either, Tom Durkin, and I'm sitting right on the finish line, too. Point Given and Macho Uno right together at the line. There's the finish.
Macho Uno looks like he maybe got just a barest nod.
You can say that, Charles. I'm not going to venture a guess.
Don't hold me to it. What a finish. Point Given was absolutely flying. Macho Uno looked like he had it clear. I'm sure that Bailey maybe relaxed for a split second, never dreaming someone was coming as fast as Point Given. Nobody seems to know.
Well, Jerry Bailey and... Lucho Uno, Gary Stevens on point given. Looked like they were all looking around to their fellow jockeys saying, who got it? Do you know, Donna? Have they been able to decide who won it?
I just now talked to Gary Stevens, and he asked me what Tom Durkin said. Gary, what do you think? Do you think he got up in time?
I don't know. It's very close. Jerry's horse really pulled up the last couple strides. My horse surged. Too close to call for me.
All right. Well, congratulations if you got it. And if you guys give me a second, I'll catch up with Jerry Bailey. Here he is.
Hey,
Jerry,
pretty good.
Jerry, Gary wasn't sure. What's your call?
Either, but, you know, my horse ducked out. He was ducking from everything. He pulled up in Canada. I was trying to keep him from doing that today, but I don't know about the finish.
Good luck. All right, back to you guys. Unknown here.
All right, Donna. Well, Macho Uno was running greenly, ducking in and out, and still got to the line in a finish too close to call with point given.
Only Macho Uno's fourth start of his life. He would be eligible to still be a little bit green. Great deal of promise here.
And the results show it is Macho Uno. The photo results just put up before the crowd here at Churchill Downs. So two in a row for Frank Stronach, Joe Orsino, and Jerry Bailey. Wow, what a finish. Macho Uno and point given right together on the line. And the photo shows Macho Uno, the gray son of Holy Bull, hanging on for the victory. Well, Macho Uno showed his greenness, only three starts. And here is the official photo. And you can see that clearly Macho Uno in the black silks on the inside is the winner over point given. You saw Jerry Bailey sort of shake his head there. That's how tight that finish was. So it is Macho Uno over point given in Street Cry. Will he be the one to break the Derby jinx? Back to Churchill Downs right after this.
The flu, a serious and highly contagious disease that affects everyone, young and old. Just think about how many ways you can catch the flu right here. By not getting your flu shot, you could give the flu to someone else too, perhaps even someone at risk who could wind up in the hospital with serious complications, including bronchitis, pneumonia, kidney failure, and even heart failure. Protect yourself. Protect your family. Get the flu shot.
Everyone's going to the Walmart anniversary event, where Tide is only $11.78, Hi-Fi Memorex VCRs are $98.97, and Blue Whale and Great White Pillows are $4.93. You just won't find a better deal anywhere else. Only until November 5th.
Saturday night at 6:30 Eastern, the first game is the Leafs at St. Louis. Second game is Calgary home to Pittsburgh. How about Frank Stronach? Couple of wins this afternoon. Let's go back to NBC for more on Macho Uno.
Macho Uno wins the juvenile by a whisker over point given, paying $14.60, $7.60, and $5.80. His half-brother, Awesome Again, won the Classic here at Churchill Downs 2 years ago. The exacta, $124, as Jerry Bailey wins his 11th Breeders' Cup race, his second in a row today. Trevor?
What a tremendous finish that one was. Macho Uno almost lost it in the final 50 yards over here. You watch him swerve pretty badly away from left-handed whipping. He's obviously very tired. Here he is right here in the black colors. That's Macho Uno. On the extreme outside over here is number one, point given. And this is Street Cry over here, who's going to finish up in the third spot. But watch the horse in the the black on the inside. That's Macho Uno. You see, he goes under a left-handed whip here. He's tired. He doesn't like that. He's still a young horse, and he shifts away. He says, no more of that. I'm going to take a dive to the right over here. Lucky Jerry Bailey puts the stick away, straightens him up, and that was the difference between winning and losing right there. He hung on from a flying point given, but almost got snatched away in those final few drums when he shifted away from that left-handed whip. Let's go down now to Bob Neumeier.
With Gary Stevens, a tough luck second in this race, with point given, way wide on the turn. How come?
Well, I was told to ride a relaxed race on him today. They didn't want him as close as he was in the Champagne. I'd worked him in the morning, had a ton of confidence in him, a ton of traffic going on up in front of me, a lot of bumping and jostling, and once I got this horse in stride, I just wanted to keep him out of trouble, and he dang near got the job done. I don't think I'm going to have to look any further for my Derby horse. I know he loves Churchill Downs, and he's a colt that is still learning. He's got a huge future ahead of him, and you know, I've had some great moments here at Churchill Downs, and I've had some bitter moments, and this is one of them.
And to follow up, for the Thoroughbred Corporation, when you left this game, the same people that you worked with as well.
Right. I wanted this race so bad, my previous employers, and I'm going to continue to ride for them in the future, and you know, it would have been something very, very special. I talked to Prince Ahmed, saw him in down in the paddock, and it was the first time I'd seen him since I've started back riding. It was a little emotional, and he said that he was going to break down in tears if this horse won, and I was hoping we could get the job done, but unfortunately we couldn't.
A nostril away, Gary Stevens is back again in racing.
Macho Uno is back as well as he heads to the barn after bringing home the money in the juvenile. Let's go to Mike for the presentation.
Thanks, Tom. You guys didn't even have to leave. You could have just stayed up here from the last race. Two in a row. What an impressive job, Mr. Stronach, Jerry Bailey, Joe Arsino, to make the presentation. We have the NTRA commissioner and CEO, Tim Smith. Tim?
Congratulations, Frank, and your family and your connections on another Breeders' Cup championship. Congratulations.
Thank you, Tim.
Could you ever imagine winning two Breeders' Cup races in a row?
Yeah, sometimes you dream, but a man has to dream. Actually, the name says as much. Owner means the number one man.
Number one man.
Yeah.
Well, the number one man may have been Jerry Bailey, because Jerry, about mid-stretch there, you got into this horse left-handed, and he did about a left-hand turn on you. You really had to snatch him up there.
You know, he did this in Canada. He kind of balked when he made the lead. He's playing around. He's still young and inexperienced, and I thought if I caught him left-handed, it might keep his attention. The reverse happened. He ducked out and kind of lost his composure, and he had to gather himself before the other horse caught him.
And you got there just by a nose, and did you know you'd won that race?
I did not, but it would have been a shame if he'd gotten beat, because he is, I think, the best horse. If he has something to run at, he runs faster, but he thought the job was over.
And another great job of training by Joe Arsino. Joe, you had this horse just ready for a spectacular performance. He turned in the best race that he's ever run, and he got there by a nose.
Well, he needed to run the best race today, because this was a quality bunch of field. These horses were, they're exceptional, and I think you'll see every one of them in May, so hopefully we can get them straightened out by then.
That's the goal, the first Saturday in May?
Yeah, hopefully.
Jerry?
Well, why not?
All right. And two wins in a row for Frank Stronach, for Jerry Bailey, and for Joe Arsino. Tom?
And Mike, what a touch of irony with the trophy presentation, the trophy presented by Tim Smith, head of the NTRA, to Frank Stronach, who is pulling his tracks from the NTRA. They've been adversaries over much of the past few weeks, and ironically meeting in the winner's circle here at Churchill Downs on Breeders' Cup Day. And we too look forward to being beneath the twin spires the first Saturday in May as the Kentucky Derby comes to NBC for the first time in 2001. Perhaps Macho Uno and Point Given will renew their rivalry then. Meanwhile, Breeders' Cup Day charges on here at Churchill Downs. The turf is next. And here are the morning line odds. Kalanisi, 7-2. Fantastic Light, 8-1 shot. Monjou from Europe, 5-2. Morning line favorite. Fruits of Love, 30. Cyril, 8. And Mandar, 4-1. Ali's Alley, a long shot. Mutamom, 15-1. John's Call, 8-1 shot. Long shots, Quiet Resolve, Down the Aisle, and Williams News. So Jerry Bailey, with two victories in a row here on Breeders' Cup Day, has tied Pat Day for the most wins ever in Breeders' Cup racing. 11 now for Jerry Bailey. Macho Uno was all over the place, but Barry got him home by a nose.
sending video mail
instead of email.
This year, the internet will allow millions of businesses to make phone calls for free.
One day, a business not on the internet will not be in business.
Are you ready?
Are you ready?
Are you ready?
Virtually all internet traffic travels across the systems of one company, Cisco Systems, empowering the internet generation.
Are you ready?
Are you?
Enjoy a slice of medium coffee for just $2.29.
Would you expect your car to protect you? With sensors that know where your seat is positioned and the severity of the crash so the airbags could react to you? Would you expect your car to put you in a more comfortable driving position? With pedals that could adjust to how long your legs are? The Taurus SE, with the most advanced safety system in its class, and the only car in its class with power adjustable pedals. Expect more.
My name is Master Chief Billy Sunday, and I am God. Diving is the most dangerous job in the Navy.
I'm not just good at it, he's born for it.
If it's lost underwater, he finds it. If it's sunk, he brings it up.
Got a man dying down there. Stand fast, Chief.
He'll
Sunday.
Be dead before you get to him.
I'm ready. Let me go.
If he's lucky, he'll die young 200 feet beneath the waves, for that is the closest he'll ever get to being a hero.
What makes you try so hard? Because they said I couldn't have it.
Men of Honor, Friday, only in theaters.
Two great empires clash.
All notions of peace are now at an end.
In a war to settle Canada's fate.
I await the news from France with impatience and dread.
Canada, a people's history. Sunday at 8 on CBC.
Back at Churchill Downs, Breeders' Cup 17, down to the final two races. Up next, the $2 million turf, Kalanisi 5-1, Fantastic Light 13-1, Manjou now 5-1, so is Ciro. Mandar 7-2, 7-2, the money showing on Mandar has become the lukewarm favorite. John's Call at 9-2, down the aisle at 9-1. And one of the jockeys we'll be seeing in the turf, a man well known to Breeders' Cup fans, a man with flair, Frankie Dettori. For his story, let's go back to Jimmy Roberts.
Well, Tom, you're absolutely right. He's perhaps one of Britain's best-known jockeys. And to fans in America, they may know his flamboyance from his somewhat gymnastic dismount from his mounts. He says that's a salute to the great Angel Cordero. But there are two other items in the last couple of years which have gone a long way to influencing who he is today. And both of them, interestingly enough, have to do with losses. Number one, a plane crash 5 months ago in England where what he almost lost was his life. And number two, the 1998 Breeders' Cup Classic aboard Swain, where what he lost was respect.
Perhaps I was too eager to win. But I didn't want to get too close to Silver Charm because I didn't want to get in a fight with him. So I was trying to keep a little bit of distance. You know, I made a mistake. The horse veered because I hit him on the left. The Breeders' Cup, it comes at the end of the year. And then you have about 6 months to sit cold on it and think about it. So I felt like then I paid for it then. I lost a lot of respect. That probably hurt me the most. Not too bad, one mistake in 12 years. Delamy was special. It was a self-vendetta for me. I just wanted to show the American people that I wasn't so bad.
A flying leap.
Out of a plane crash.
fact, Patrick McKee, the pilot, did perish. But Dettori credits McKee with saving his life. He and fellow jockey Ray Cochran had just a few minutes to escape from the decimated Piper Seneca before it burst into flames.
They all say, I've seen my life flash in front of me. I didn't see that. The only thing went through my mind is I was disappointed that I was going to die. I don't get carried away as much as I used to anymore. You know, and I guess Swain and the plane crash, I guess, have contributed to that feeling. I'm not going to chase race after race. When you start talking like that, they're already thinking, oh, he's gone, you know, he hasn't got the fighting spirit in him anymore. And like every weekend, I have to go out there and prove them wrong.
A postscript, Ray Cochran, he's now retired. As for Dettori, he says he's not taking small planes any longer on short hops, I should say. He now drives. Tom, he doesn't want to press his luck anymore.
And who could blame him? Frankie Dettori on his way from the jocks room to the paddock. And that story touching home with a plane crash earlier this week. And we heard earlier from Gary Garber, the owner of Flamethrower and the Juvenile, who himself survived a mishap. Going from Hawaii, headed toward Australia and New Zealand, a plane had its cargo door come open and the pressure created a giant hole in the side of the aircraft. 9 were killed, but Gary Garber survived, and like Frankie Dettori, counting their blessings to be here at the Breeders' Cup today. Here are the odds for the Breeders' Cup turf. Kalinowski at 5. Fantastic Light, that's Dettori's mount. He's 13-1. Monjou is 9-2. 5-1 on John's Call, 9-1 on Down the Aisle. So the horses being tacked up, as they say, saddle put on, girth applied, and bit. That's a tongue tie going down on one of those to keep the horse from getting his tongue over the bit. We're getting set for the Breeders' Cup turf. We're back to Churchill Downs in just a moment.
As NBC goes to commercial, we stay live here at Churchill Downs in Kentucky. Frank Stronach, with 2 wins this afternoon, now has 3 in Breeders' Cup competition. That puts him ahead of Samson Farm. Samson Farm won with Dan Smartley here in the Distaff in 91, 97 in California in the turf with Chief Bearheart. Now the turf is up next, and Samson does have Quiet Resolve, the winner of last year's Atto Mile in Toronto, in this race. We spoke with trainer Mark Frostad. Frostad is somewhat concerned about this distance at 1.5 miles.
The 1.5 miles would probably be a stretch for this horse. His best trip is probably between 1.8 miles and 1.375 miles. But we're hoping for a firm turf, and if he gets that, and if things go his way, if he gets a slow pace, he'll get the 1.5 miles.
Well, the turf is certainly firm here this afternoon. Witness the upsets, the fast times. Big loss for Canadian racing when Ernie Samuel passed away in May. Still, it has been a banner year on the racetrack for this Samson stable.
We've had a great year. We've won the plate, the Oaks, and it's just been a very good year. We've had a lot of great performances by different horses, which is nice. It's been spread through the stable, and so it's been a lot of fun. It's sad that Mr. Samuel's not here for the whole year, really, because he would have had a great time.
He would have had a great time indeed. Listen, Ernie Samuel would have asked the question we've been asking. No one's mentioned it yet. What about the Europeans? No one's referred to the Europeans here. That has been a story, their lack of accomplishment today.
A couple of things they were supposed to love about being here. The cool weather, it didn't develop this week. It took a long time. Only today is it cool. We don't have a giving turf course, and that's against them. The long stretch should help them here, though. They didn't win 2 years ago when they came, and they were supposed to. We'll see if they can start winning now with the turf up next.
All right, just a couple of seconds. Turf race is up. How about a European in this race with your picks?
Well, it's quite possible. We have several Europeans in this race. Mandar is a horse that used to run in Europe. Fantastic Light is coming from Europe after a stop in New York. And Cyril is a 3-year-old who I think has some big races in front of him.
Well, again, the European horses have yet to win here this afternoon at Churchill Downs. What about the turf? Well, let's get back to NBC.
Welcome back to Churchill Downs. We have an update for you on Spanish Fern, the filly that was injured in the filly and mare turf race earlier. She sustained an injury to her left hind leg, leaving the gate. She's been taken to Lexington to Root and Riddle for more x-rays. They have a little more sophisticated equipment down there. Horses are making their way to the track for the Breeders' Cup Turf. Calanisi 5-1, 12-1 Fantastic Light, Monjou at 4, 0 at 6, and Mandar at 4-1. John's Call, a 5-1 shot down the aisle, is 9-1. So John's Call, a 5-1 shot. Charles C., an interesting story. The horse is a former hurdle horse.
Well, he certainly is a sentimental favorite here at 5-1. He's won two major stakes this year, the Turf Classic and the Man of War. But yes, he was bought for $4,000 to be a jumper, and he did actually run over jumps. He's 9 years old now, remember, so this is kind of ancient history. He ran over jumps some, and then they started running more on the flat, and he was kind of a high-priced claimer. Then he became a pretty good allowance horse. Then he would run a couple of listed stakes, and they ran him back over hurdles one more time. He fell on his head. It was like he picked himself up and dusted himself up and said, I don't want to do that anymore. I'm going to be a really good horse now. So for the last 2 years, he's become a major contender in stakes races at the age of 8 and 9 years old, and he's now a Grade 1 winner, the oldest horse ever to compete in the Breeders' Cup, and he's a big strapping fella. There's a good look at him there. Pretty handsome chestnut horse. I think one of the secrets to his longevity is that his trainer, Tom Voss, an old friend from Maryland, has a lovely farm up there, and John lives on the farm and trains on beautiful open gallops, almost like an English-style life, stays turned out a lot, and is just his mental attitude stays so good, and he thinks he's about 4 and a half his age instead of 9. Somebody said they think that his lip tattoo is done in Roman numerals, but I don't think that's true.
Well, the oldest horse ever at the Breeders' Cup at the ripe old age of 9, John's Call. Number one is Calanisi, owned by the Aga Khan, the Harvard-educated spiritual leader of the Ismaili Muslims and one of Thoroughbred Racing's leading international owners and breeders. This is the horse of the moment off a win over Monjou, but he's never been a mile and a half. Number two, Fantastic Light, Godolphin Code, ridden by Dottori. He came from Europe to win Belmont's Man of War, then was fourth behind John's Call in the Turf Classic. Number three, Subtle Power, Bill Mott, Jerry Bailey combination. They became so familiar when they had Cigar a few years ago. Group winner in Europe. This three-year-old finished seventh in the Turf Classic. Number four is Monjou, named for a chateau in Burgundy, France, and maybe the most accomplished European ever to come to the Breeders' Cup. Winner of the Arc, the French, and Irish Derbies last year. He added three Group 1s and a Group 2 as a four-year-old this year. But there are questions. He's lost his last two. This will be his final race. Number five, Fruits of Love. Owner Michael Doyle is a commercial fisherman from County Donegal, Ireland. This horse has raced only twice this year, but four of his five career wins in Europe were at a mile and a half. Number six is Ciro, three-year-old colt trained by transplanted Frenchman Christophe Clement. Ciro is a transplanted Irish-based colt, now 2-for-2 in the States, winning the Grade 1 Secretariat and the Lawrence Realization. Seven, Mandar, originally owned by the Aga Khan, campaigned in Europe, but now in the hands of Bo Greeley. Among his wins, the Woodford Reserve over this Churchill Downs turf course, but he's been off since mid-August, may not want a mile and a half. Number eight, Ali's Alley, Edgar Prado, native of Peru, finished second aboard Ali's Alley in the 98 Juvenile, but he's a long shot here, having won only once the last 2 years. Number nine, Mutamam, owned by Sheikh Hamdan and ridden by Richard Hills, whose twin brother Michael is also a jockey. Another brother and his father are trainers. Mutamam has won three in Europe this year, but not in top company. 10 is the aforementioned John's Call, looking for that senior citizens discount. As a 9-year-old, Nashville's Doug Joyce put up $240,000 to make him eligible. He did earn the shot today with a front-running victory in the Turf Classic. 11, Quiet Resolve, Canadian-owned, bred, and trained, 5-year-old gelding. He's not been off the board in 6 starts this year, mostly Group 2 company. Number 12, Down the Aisle, bred and owned by Charles Dieters of Walton, Kentucky. If he wins, it could be a crowded winner's circle. Dieters has 11 kids. Down the Aisle, a 7-year-old with a good record, but stepping up in competition today. And number 13 is Williams News, the first Breeders' Cup horse for On Target Stable. That's the Cirillo family of Dallas, including newlyweds Emil and Nicole. Williams News draws in after a nose defeat. In fact, everyone thought he had won at Woodbine in the Canadian International. That's the field for the Breeders' Cup Turf. It's a tough race. Monjou has the credentials, but lost his last two. How do you see it, Mike and Bob?
Well, you're right, Tom. It is a tough race, and Monjou has been the king of Europe for the past 2 years, winning 11 out of 15, but for the first time in his career, he comes off two straight losses.
Anytime the favorite on the board, Mike, is 7-2, 4-1, you know the fans are probing for that winner. This is a very difficult race to handicap. We're going to talk about the Europeans because they are fascinating. I begin with Kalanisi, who is my tepid pick for this race. She's done everything you could ask in Europe. She's beat Monjou, two tough losses to Giants Causeway, who we'll see later in the Classic. The big question here is the distance, though. 8 starts, 5 wins, 3 seconds. She's never been longer than a mile and a quarter.
And you're right. Last time out, he beat Monjou at a mile and a quarter, but he's never been that far. Monjou, on the other hand, 8 starts at a mile and a half, 7 wins. There's a shot of Monjou on the racetrack, and I just think it's a matter of if he handles this race course, and if he's not over the top, as they say in Europe. He gets to have medication this afternoon. He gets the Butte and the Lasix. I think that could help if he's got some nagging little injuries, and I definitely think that he's the best horse in the race. If he doesn't fire, take a look at this horse, Ciro. He's right now at 6-1. He has proven it a mile and a half. He comes off a huge race in the Lawrence Realization last time out. He overcame a lot of trouble, still got up for the win, Bob.
Well, before we introduce our European analyst, we thought it was kind of cute that last year's Eclipse Award-winning photograph was taken by Mike Martin of the Daily Racing Form. This is an NBC simulation of that photo, not the actual, but look at the lower left-hand corner of your screen. John McCrerick, Mutton Chops himself, exulting in victory with his man Frankie Dettori.
How sweet it was. Do you know, we were gone right through the meeting, no winner. 3 times Europe has not had a winner at the Breeders' Cup. It looked like being a fourth and Day Lamy, but Frankie Dettori, the man, after Swain here 2 years earlier, a magnificent moment to exult.
All right, Mr. Chops, yesterday's news, what about this race? Monjou, Kalanisi, what do you think?
Well, Monjou, Mike, as you say, the best horse in the race. He's never been a bigger price in his life in 15 starts. The last 6 starts, he's been at odds on. He was odds on to beat Kalanisi. It's a mile and a half against him. He doesn't like the ground. He prefers going right-handed to left. He could lug out, but medication. And I tell you, one of the defining moments of the Breeders' Cup is going to be when Mick Kanaan comes in the straight, on the steel, holding Monjou. You're waiting. Will he find or won't he find? It could be explosive. It could be a dud.
Well, John, I want to, if we can, take a look at the English odds, because I think this is very interesting, and compare them the way the horses are being bet. Can you explain this, John?
Well, Kalanisi favourite over in Britain. There's a lot of opposition there to Monjou. So, but it's 9-2 here. Monjou's been backed on the board from 5-1 to 7-2 here, and is favourite at the moment. But Kalanisi, one favourite on the form book, but only 3 horses have ever won the turf, not having won it over a mile.
Looks like Monjou's...
I didn't get all that, Bob. Did you get
it
all that?
It looks like Monjou's dead on the board. I mean, a champion
He's been back. No. It's now 7-2 from 5-1, so it has been back. I tell you, a big price on the board, number 9, Muterman. 35-1. If they get it out of the stalls, his stall is the problem. He has his nervousness. They get him out, he can get a lead. Don't let him run loose, you Americans. Muterman at a big, big price at 35-1, an improving horse.
That's a run of the window. Subdued. That's a little subdued for Mutton Chops.
Well, I don't know. Monjou and Muterman will do for me. We've got to get a winner somewhere for this day.
He's worse than us. He picks everybody. Good old Mutton Chops. Glad to have him aboard, Tom.
Did you see all those diamond rings on Mutton Chops? I'm starting to listen to him instead of you guys. John's call, Monjou, and quiet resolve, the pick of the cyber cappers. Mike agrees with Monjou, and Bob taking the Aga Khan's horse, Kalanisi. So, as we might expect, everybody split here. This is a tough race to pick a winner. Cyber cappers go for the old guy, John's call. There's a look at the Aga Khan's horse, Kalanisi. Well, it's quite a transition for the European horses to get on this tight, turned turf course. Donna Barton, what's it look like down by the starting gate? Donna Barton Brothers, I keep calling you by your riding name and not your married name.
That's all right. I'm used to it. I call myself by my riding name half the time. I'll tell you what, these European horses are handling it very well. I think it's probably because it's such a cool day. They've been training here for a few days. Some went with a pony, some didn't, but they're all walking onto the grass course like they've been here for a few years. Right now, as I say that, the number 9, Mutamam, hesitates to walk onto the grass.
And Kalanisi now being blindfolded to be let in.
You're right, and now Kalanisi gets blindfolded, and Kalanisi also hesitated to walk onto the turf, but none of them have turned a hair. None of them look like they're ruining the race in the post parade, and I think that it should be a fair race.
Donna, do you ride differently on the grass than you would on the dirt?
hitting your horses in the face, and it helps you to rate your horse so much better. But on the grass, you don't have that advantage, and a lot of times you'll be back there, and your horse will be rank and trying to run over top of horses, and you really have to ride with a much more patience and quiet hands.
The European horses, too, the style of racing, as you see, a subtle power, the Irish bred going in, is a little different. They gallop along and then finish strongly. More pace usually in American races. Is that an adjustment for the European jockeys?
Yeah, the Europeans like to keep them covered up. That's what they're used to in their training. And then when they see daylight, they run as fast as they can until the wire. And sometimes if they get out too early, they can't run that fast to the wire.
All right, loading in good order here. The Breeders' Cup turf, the purse, $2,480,000 as they go a mile and a half on the Matt Wynn turf course here at Churchill Downs. There's a look at Williams News. Let's go to Tom Durkin.
They're in the gate. And they're off. Ali Zelli raking alertly today. Quiet resolve was there. Mutamam was off a step slowly, but he's rushed up, and he's rushing for the early lead and takes to the inside. Mutamam intent on that lead, but Ali Zelli is right there with him, and those two are going fairly quickly early. Mutamam backs off. Ali Zelli the leader. John's Call right up there running in third. Quiet resolve is fourth. Fantastic Light is fifth. Zero in traffic. Checked. Racing sixth. Mandar in the clear is seventh on the outside. Williams Nose is three wide eighth, and Colonisi is a ground-saving ninth. Roots of Love is now 10th, and that Subtle Power down toward the inside beneath Jerry Bailey. Down the aisle has settled comfortably at the back of the pack. Monchou is the last of them all as they make their way by us for the first time. Ali Zelli has taken command. A tepid opening quarter there in 24 3/5 seconds. So after that quick first furlong, they were able to slow it down considerably, and the moderating pace continues. Mutamam is second. Wide Resolve is third. John's Call has been adroitly maneuvered over to the inside to be fourth. Mandar Hald held fifth. Down toward the inside, Fantastic Light, followed by Ciro, and then it's Williams News, Fruits of Love, Colin Macy, Subtle Power at the back with the long striding gray down the aisle, who continues to run in the clear on the outside. Monchou has been 13th throughout. The pace is pedestrian. Three quarters in 1:15.1. So the field of 13 moves down the backstretch. Ali Zelli with the lead. Mutamam in the clear. Canadian Quiet Resolve edging up to join the leaders. And the stalwart John's Call drafting in behind horses, running fourth with about four furlongs to go here. And then it's Bandaro's in the clear fifth. Fantastic Light moving up methodically toward the inside. Followed now by Ciro. Williams News is on the far outside and in the clear. Colonisi is in a tough spot. He's got about eight horses in front of him, and he's down toward the inside as the field moves round the far turn. Ali Zelli, Mutamam is right at his neck. Quiet Resolve just outside him. He's put to a drive. John's Call ready to roll. He's in behind horses. Mandar swings into action on the outside. Fantastic Light right there toward the rose. Only five lengths for the lead. Colonisi has switched to the outside, and he's coming with his run now, and they're coming into the final furlong. Nothing left for Ali Zelli. Quiet Resolve has taken the lead. On the inside, Mutamam. John's Call doing his best. Still running in third. Colonisi with the flying finish. Fantastic Light is coming too. Here comes John's Call. Here comes Colonisi. Quiet Resolve next up. Here's the line. Colonisi caught him right at the wire. Colonisi is the winner with a jubilant Johnny Murtaugh board and a three-way photo per second there among John's Call, Quiet Resolve, and Mutamam. Well, we flash back to the first Breeders' Cup back in 1984, when those same subs of the Aga Khan, worn that day by Longshot Lashkari, flashed under the wire first. Today, it's Colonisi to take the turf.
All right, Tom Durkin, Colonisi, the Irish-bred four-year-old colt by Doyoun, out of Calamba by Green Dancer, and ridden by John Murtaugh to victory in the turf. Donna.
John Murtaugh, congratulations on your Breeders' Cup victory. This Irish bred horse is now an American champion. Tell me about your trip.
Yes, this horse is he's a really genuine horse, you know. Beautiful trip along the inside, I switched him to the outside, down the straight. It's a great battle, you know. He really stuck his head down, and he just got there.
So as soon as you asked him, he unleashed for you?
Yes, he was great, you know, great today.
Congratulations, John. Back to you guys.
John Murtaugh, what a year he has had, and Colonisi gives him another victory as he discusses it with Richard Hills on Mutamam. Colonisi, Quiet Resolve, here are the last strides, and Colonisi, not yet even in your picture, coming in the green seat. Silks on the extreme outside. John Murtaugh has him in stride. He is coming to quiet resolve, and he is going to go right past him. Under the hand ride now from Murtaugh. And Calanese goes by to give the Aga Khan another Breeders' Cup victory. It's Calanese in the Breeders' Cup turf.
We all start out with dreams. As you explore life's opportunities, the right planning and advice can make them a reality. Standard Life can help you now to realize your childhood dreams and turn your investments into a roaring success. Realize your childhood dreams and more. Standard Life. Profit from our knowledge.
Give you the information that you need to begin your week, and perhaps even tell you a little bit about the news stories that you're going to see develop over the course of the days to come.
Sunday Report with Allison Smith on CBC Television. Astride Calanese, who wins the Breeders' Cup turf, and Calanese's not done yet. While we're away, here's what happened. Calanese and John Murtaugh, he pulled him up heading back, and whoa, Calanese sent Murtaugh to the track. Murtaugh holds on to the reins, and no harm done. But in the morning's training here the past week at Churchill Downs, Calanese has been, well, how to say it, wild. And he was wild, too, charging down the stretch to win the turf. Trevor?
A really classy win here from a classy horse. 9 starts, 6 wins and 3 seconds. This guy's never been out of the first two. Another good ride from John Murtaugh, who was an unknown about 5 years ago, but has he come a long way? He's now up in the upper echelon of European riders. We'll be hearing a lot more from John Murtaugh in upcoming Breeders' Cups, that for sure. But this 4-year-old Calanese, perfectly timed run on the outside. A little bit unlucky in the race was Fantastic Light. The 2-horse Franco Dettori really didn't have anywhere to go on him. I don't think he would have won it, but he would have gone a little closer. But really a class win from Calanese, perfectly timed. And what a game run from that runner-up. Quiet Resolve, 40-1. He almost held on. And then also good runs from that 9-year-old John's Core and Mutamon. But this guy, you can see right here, he's not a big horse, not a striking-looking horse, but man, does he have heart. You watch the replay right here. Let's go to Calanese. Right, he is right here on the extreme outside. And here is the 11 who's going to finish up in the second position. That is Quiet Resolve. Calanese, you can see there, John Murtaugh just shaking the reins at him right now. He's going to try to shift in just a little. You see over here, he gets a right-handed whip, and he doesn't like that either. You can see him shifting in here. So Murtaugh puts the whip away, straightens him up, and he hand rides him the last 50 yards or so. And although it's very, very close, he doesn't need that whip. He gets up close home to beat Quiet Resolve. On the inside, we had Mutamon, that white-faced Mutamon at the rail, running a huge race as well. And if you look back into fifth, you'll see Fantastic Light, just a tad unlucky on the afternoon. But perhaps the best horse on the day, Calanese, got the job done this afternoon to take the Breeders' Cup turf for Sir Michael Stout and John Murtaugh. Very convincing win by Calanese. Also good to see His Highness the Aga Khan. He's put in so much into racing. Of course, they go back generations. They go back to the turn of the century. The Aga Khans have been racing and breeding racehorses. So a great win for that family this afternoon. Actually, Irish bred Calanese, the 4-year-old son of De Jong. And here's John Murtaugh. What a couple of years it's been for him. He's just winning everything in sight these last few days, including the Dubai Champion Stakes last time out on this guy, Calanese. There he is, John Murtaugh, young Irishman, doing extremely well. Let's go back now to Tom.
All right, Trevor. Murtaugh gets the victory, and he's talking there to Michael Stout, Sir Michael Stout, who has his second Breeders' Cup victory. He had Bill Sutsky on the turf in 96, and for Murtaugh, his second as well, he rode Ridgewood Pearl to victory in the mile in 95. $11.20 27-24-60 on the winner. Quiet Resolve, 28-13. And what about the valiant effort with a 9-year-old, John's Call, the oldest horse to run at the Breeders' Cup, paid 620, 416 on the exacta, 5,700 on the triple. And there is Kalanisi, owned by the Aga Khan. The Aga Khan is the spiritual leader of the Ismaili Muslims, living mostly in Pakistan and India. In fact, the present Aga Khan was a student at Harvard when he learned that his grandfather, the Aga Khan, had bypassed his father, Prince Ali Khan, to name the youngster, the college student, as his successor as Aga Khan. Back in the old days, his subjects used to weigh the Aga Khan and give him his weight in gold and precious jewels. That doesn't happen anymore, but the Aga Khan says that his followers draw great inspiration from his racing successes. It gives them something to rally around, and that's why he has been such an avid thoroughbred owner and breeder over all these years. Has a beautiful farm in Ireland where this colt was bred. So the turf goes to a European, which we've seen often at the Breeders' Cup in the 17 renewals of the Breeders' Cup turf. This is their game. So while the cheers and Murtaugh celebrates, the next act is about to unfold. Kenny Rice already walking over for the Classic. The big race coming up next. He's with Nick Zito.
Thanks, Tom. Nick Zito has been on this same path around the track at Churchill Downs in 91 with Strike the Gold and 94 with Gopher Jen. Both those is Kentucky Derby winners. And you're going over now with Albert the Great, a son of Gopher Jen. Nick, how's he doing coming into this?
Well, he couldn't be training any better, Kenny. You know, right now my confidence level isn't too high after the last race, but Albert pulled it out last time and, you know, ran one of the fastest mile and a quarters ever by a three-year-old. So hopefully he could do what his daddy did on this track.
You are going up against Fusaichi Pegasus again. In the Jerome, you finished 4.5 lengths behind him in third place. Has Albert the Great improved that much? Will it take that much improvement?
Well, I think so, and he's going to have to do that. You know, I think so, because if he doesn't, then Fuchiachi, you know, whatever it is, will be tough. But I think he has, Kenny. I honestly do.
Earlier this week, Nick, you went for basically almost a gallop with him. You didn't have a real strong workout, but you said you felt comfortable with that. Do you still feel that way?
Yeah, I do, Kenny, because, you know, those horses go over the top sometimes, and you like to just keep them there, and that's what we're trying to do, just maintain his strength and hopefully, you know, his fitness, and everything will go okay.
Okay, thanks very much. Good luck to you, Nick. Okay, let's check in now with Bob Neumeyer.
Well, Tom, I'm walking on the clubhouse turf.
All right, as the horses for the Classic make their way over, let's go back to Mike for the presentation for the turf. Mike?
All right, to make the presentation to a representative of the Aga Khan, Mr. Pat Downs, we have D.G. Van Cleef. And, D.G., do the honors, the president of Breeders' Cup Limited.
Thank you, Mike. Mr. Downs, congratulations. Wonderful horse, wonderful win. But be careful, it's heavy.
Thank you very much.
And to Sir Michael Stout, what a job having this horse ready for the first time he's ever been a mile and a half.
Yes, but he's a very tough horse and a very, very good horse. He hasn't got the credit he's deserved in the past, especially over his Champion Stakes win at Newmarket. And look at the acceleration he's got, you know. And the boys, the team have done a great job, too, being out here 12 days.
And he beat Manjou last time out, and Manjou really didn't fire today. It was a close race, though. He had to really go by some tough American horses.
Yeah, we were drawn one, and we got a little further back than we wanted to. But once he pulled out and he saw some daylight, he really quickened.
All right, thank you very much. Congratulations. Tom?
All right, Mike. So one celebration continues and another about ready to begin. Bob Neumeyer's walking over with the star of the moment, Fusaichi Pegasus.
And what a great thrill it is, Tom Hammond. And this is the big man, the son of Mr. Prospector. This is his last race. He made this very same walk on the first Saturday in May. At that time, well, he was racing's Wonder Horse, the greatest thing since the Hot Fudge Sunday. And he won in smashing style. But since then, he lost the Preakness, had a few minor injuries, and around that time was syndicated for, about $50 or $60 million. So why they bring him back? Well, $4 million purse for one. Number two is if he wins, Coolmore Stud, who has that juicy deal for this horse. Well, they can raise their stud fees considerably, because winning the Breeders' Cup Classic and the Kentucky Derby in the same year would be gangbusters financially and for a prestige point of view. Neil Drysdale walking alongside. We asked him if he'd had a comment, and Neil said after the race. Tom, back to you.
As well he should, all business, Neil Drysdale. Let's go back down to Mike Battaglia now.
Okay, Tom, to make a special presentation to Calanisi, winner of Leg 8 of the Emirates World Series, on behalf of Emirates Airlines, Boutros Boutros.
On behalf of Emirates Airlines, I'd like to congratulate the winner and thank Churchill Downs and Breeders' Cup for the lovely event.
Thank you very much. And again, congratulations, Sir Michael Stout.
Thank you very much indeed.
Tom?
All right, Mike. So here's the official order of finish in the Breeders' Cup turf. With Calanisi, Quiet Resolve, and John's Call. Monjou, his last race, he finishes seventh. Obviously had gone off his form the last three times. Mandar was in eighth. The early pace setter, Ali Zali, faded to ninth. Subtle Power, Fruits of Love, down the aisle, and Williams News. So the Classic is coming up. Fusa Ichi Pegasus is the favorite. How much is he worth? Well, Bob said 50 or 60. We've heard 60 or 70. In any event, it's a lot of money. Captain Steve opens the betting at 10 to 1. Golden Missile and Cat Thief, the defending champion, 15 to 1 each. Guided Tour at 50. Albert the Great, 5 to 1. So is Lemon Drop Kid. Who would have thought you could get that on Lemon Drop Kid a month or two ago? Fusa Ichi Pegasus on the morning line was 8 to 5. Tiznow, three-year-old challenger at 5-1, and Giants Causeway from Europe at 6-1. That's where the betting commenced today for the Breeders' Cup Classic. Meanwhile, the Breeders' Cup turf winner, John Murtaugh, celebrating his 11th Grade 1 or Group 1 victory of the year 2000.
Today, people are sending video mail
instead of email.
This year, the internet allowed
millions of businesses to make phone calls for free.
One day, a business not on the internet will not be in business.
Are you ready?
Are you ready?
Are you ready?
Virtually all internet traffic travels across the systems of one company, Cisco Systems, empowering the internet generation.
Are you ready?
Are you?
A door that won't get dings. It's not as important as an engine. Or transmission, or safety features like airbags. A door that won't get dings is a relatively small thing. So what does it say when a car company puts so much into something that's so small? It says they already took care of the things that were big.
The viewers and the critics agree. Canada, a people's history, is making a little history. A stunning, groundbreaking series. Heartfelt, dramatic. Magnificent, even magical. A masterwork of dramatic storytelling on CBC television.
She discovered the American Indian movement at a time of social unrest.
Accusing me of a number of things that I have not done.
She set a standard for being a hero.
Then suddenly this Canadian woman died in the South Dakota Badlands.
It was an execution. She didn't have a chance.
Her death has remained a mystery for 25 years. Who killed Anna May? The Fifth Estate, Wednesday night at 8 on CBC.
We've got a story about how Sony created a grassroots craze for a boy band.
This is a band that's never performed, though. Doesn't have a CD yet.
Yeah, that's the best part of it.
Undercurrent, Sunday night on CBC.
Churchill Downs. Classic. The words just seem to go together. Today, perhaps the deepest and most competitive field ever should make for a race that literally lives up to its name. There's worldwide appeal. Giants Causeway from Ireland, trained by a young prodigy. They've defeated all comers in Europe. Now they challenge America's best. Cat Thief, trained by Lucas and written by Day. An afterthought, just like last year when they won. But two horses will battle not just for victory, but the title Horse of the Year. Lemon Drop Kid, the best older horse in America. And Fusa Ichi Pegasus, Drysdale's Derby winner, the $70 million horse, returns to the scene of his greatest triumph. A classic setting. A classic race. The classic champion awaits. The favorite to be the classic champion, Fusa Ichi Pegasus, his last race. He retires to Ashford Stud, the Coolmore-operated property near Versailles, Kentucky, after this race today. Captain Steve at 14-1, Golden Missile 13-1, Cat Thief, last year's winner, bet down to 7-1. Guided to a real long shot, you saw Albert the Great. Fusa Ichi, 6-5 favorite. Pine Dance, at least 99-1. Tiznow and Giant's Causeway, 12-1 each. Neil Drysdale already has won a Breeders' Cup race today with War Chant. And now tightening the girth on Fusa Ichi Pegasus. All this week, hordes of riders and broadcasters have surrounded Drysdale, trying to discover the real Neil.
I wouldn't know how to describe myself. I wouldn't even try to start. I enjoy horses, so that's probably the primary reason why I train racehorses. I enjoy being around them. Say I'm watching a race, or some friend of mine's watching the race. They don't want to know what the trainer's feeling. They want to know the technical parts of the race. I don't answer touchy-feely questions ever to anybody, and I keep my feelings to myself. I enjoy winning races, and the opposite of that is I don't really enjoy losing races. I don't think this is a sport where you have time to walk around with your head dejected just because you lost a race. It's important to win. My method? If I knew, I wouldn't tell you anyway. This is a competitive business.
Well, whatever his method, it's a good one because for trainers that have started at least 10 horses in the Breeders' Cup, his winning percentage is highest of all. 14 minutes to post for the Breeders' Cup Classic. This is a power-packed field, though. Even though Fusa Ichi is a heavy favorite, there are many in here capable of winning. There's one of them. This is really the first time I can remember that we've had a matchup between the best three-year-old in Europe against the best three-year-old in America. This is Giant's Causeway. He carries the hope of the Europeans. He's an 11-1 shot. Giant's Causeway in the hands of one of the sport's rising stars. Their names alone can dominate the landscape. Lucas, Baffert, Drysdale. But lately, a new one from abroad has garnered much of the attention. O'Brien.
In just 2-3 years, he's hit the peaks, and he is the up-and-coming young trainer.
Tell you one thing, he's not up-and-coming, he's there. He's a top man.
What he's achieved already is pretty unique.
See, he's won 5 Group 1s off the sprint. He's won umpteen classics already.
He's an incredibly focused young man, and he's got a great future.
Great teamwork, a strong team, I think is the big secret.
He doesn't like to talk about himself, but at age 31, trainer Aidan O'Brien is the talk of the European racing community. Today he brings Giant's Causeway from Ireland, and his prized horse is one subject he'll always discuss.
He's beaten them all. He's beaten all the milers and mile and a quarter horses back in Europe. He has the stamina, speed, guts. He shows all that at home. He very rarely ever gets beat.
The 3-year-old European champion enters the Classic with huge expectations. A win over Fusa Ichi Pegasus and the American-dominated field would forever endear horse and trainer to international racing.
The Breeders' Cup is all about the best meeting the best.
He is the European champion. We want to make him the world champion.
to beat the Americans at anything's tough. What can I say?
He's passed all the tests. He's a fighter, this fella, you know. They say this is a warrior's track, and this is a warrior.
And the rider just up on Giant's Causeway, Mick Cannan, the Irish champion many times. And he'll have that tough outside post position 14. Of course, last year it was a huge upset. Cat Thief won it, trained by the leading Breeder Cup trainer of all time, Wayne Lucas. He's with Mike Battaglia.
Last year that Cat Thief at odds of 19-1 scored the big upset in this race. Wayne's already scored with one long shot, Spain. Wayne, you told me Cat Thief is going better than he was last year even.
I think so, but I think also, Mike, that it's a little bit tougher field too. I think there's more depth and, of course, more horses this year, but we're on our home court and we've been waiting 6 weeks for this day.
Well, I'll tell you what, if Wayne Lucas does manage to win this one, it's going to go down as one of the biggest upsets in Breeders' Cup history. Good luck to you, Wayne.
Thank you, Mike. They're betting us a little better this year. They're paying attention. Thank you.
All right. Tom.
All right. They're making their way out of the paddock, heading to the track. We'll take a break. We'll be back with the post parade for the big race of the day, the Breeders' Cup Classic.
Powerful. Responsive. Agile.
We're just going to the market.
The 2001 Accord EX V6 from Honda.
This is my job. The label. People think Moore's is just a place to buy suits. Actually, we make them first. That's why we put our name right here. Because Moore's isn't just a store. Moore's is us. And that's a label we are all proud to wear.
Well made, well priced, well dressed. Moore's.
In the future, a car will drive itself.
Autopilot engaged.
The perfect girlfriend is only a click away.
Hi, sugar.
But through technology, your life can be stolen.
You were illegally cloned.
Well, you cloned the wrong man. They'll do anything to destroy the evidence, and you're the evidence.
How do you know? He's not you, and you're not him.
I know who I am. The Sixth Day opens everywhere November 17th.
Your call will be answered by the next available operator. Please stand by.
Your service reps are overwhelmed with customer calls, faxes, and emails. Integrate the internet into your call center and go from providing customer support to creating customer delight. Discover all that's possible on the internet. Cisco Systems, empowering the internet generation.
And here are the horses for the Breeders' Cup Classic. Number one, Captain Steve, named by Mike Pegram for Louisville policeman Captain Steve Thompson, who helped him out of a jam. Eighth after a troubled trip in the Derby. He has won or placed his last five, never beaten more than three quarters of a length. Two, Euchre was scratched. Number three, Golden Missile, third in the Classic last year. Golden Missile peaked with a victory over Lemon Drop Kid in the Pimlico Special. That was in May, has only one win since. Four is Cat Thief, last year's shocker. He always tries hard. He hasn't won in 10 races since the Classic, but he's almost always a factor in the money in 11 Grade 1 races. Trained impressively here at Churchill Downs. Blinkers off today for the first time in over 2 years. Number five, Guided Tour. Here is a combination. Trained by transplanted Irishman Niall O'Callaghan. Ridden by transplanted Cajun Larry Melanson. Second to dust off the bottle in the Hawthorne Gold Cup. Number six is Albert the Great. Tracy Farmer named this colt for its breeder, Albert Clay. After running third to Fusaichi Pegasus in the Jerome, Albert confirmed the strength of the three-year-old division with a victory over Lemon Drop Kid in the Jockey Club Gold Cup. Number seven is Lemon Drop Kid. Dominant earlier at 1.16 of seven graded stakes. Questions arose his last two, especially his fifth in the Gold Cup. After this, he retires to Lanes End Farm, syndicated for $30 million. It goes to $40 million if he's Horse of the Year. He will be if he wins. Number 8, Dust on the Bottle, Arkansas bred, owned, and trained by the husband and wife team of Sharon and Glenn Hild. The veteran of the field with 42 career starts. He's won 3 straight, but not in this company. Number 9, Fusa Ichi Pegasus, attracted attention right from the start, topped the Keeneland sale at $4 million, became the first Derby favorite to win since 1979, and now sold for that fantastic price. Upset on a track he didn't like at the Preakness, 1 race since, an impressive win in the 1-mile Jerome. Number 10 is Pine Dance, trained by Irish champion Dermot Weld. He's had 3 U.S. starts, including wins in the American and Pennsylvania Derbies. Irish champion jockey Patrick Joseph Smullen gets his first Breeders' Cup ride. 11 is Vision and Verse, 9th in the Classic last year. He's won only once in his last 9 starts, but was bumped, still got 3rd in the Gold Cup. Number 12, Gander, a New York bred gelding and a supplemental nominee who showed dramatic improvement with a 2nd in the Gold Cup, but tackles the world's best here. 13, Tiznow, California-bred 3-year-old, another supplemental nominee. Jay Robbins from one of the Golden State's top racing families has this colt on a roll. Back-to-back front-running scores in the Super Derby in track record time and the Goodwood. And number 14, Giant's Causeway, named for a geological formation of rock columns in Ireland. Europe's top 3-year-old comes to settle the question of who's best. Never worse than 2nd in a dozen career starts. He's won 9 of them. Races on dirt for the first time, but he has trained on the dirt surface in Europe. And to eye the Classic, Bob Newmar has 2 wins today, but Mike, poor Mike, 0 for the day.
Poor Mike, he called me out. When I get sympathy from Hammond, I'm in trouble.
I've been poor in many different ways there, by the way.
Thank you.
Michael, $4 million plus on the line, horse of the year at stake. The players here at Churchill Downs think it's all about Fusa Ichi Pegasus. He is 6-5 on the board. And I think we both agree this race is a lot deeper than just this fine 3-year-old.
I really think it is, but I think Fusa Ichi Pegasus is the one to beat. If he comes in and runs his A game, he's going to be very tough. I'm going to try to beat him with another 3-year-old, and that's Albert the Great. There's a shot of Albert the Great. I loved his last race in the Gold Cup. Look at this horse when they turned for home. This is 1.25 miles, the same distance, and he just took off when they hit the top of the stretch. He was drawing away at the end. His 2 races at 1.25 miles, I think his 2 best efforts ever. I think he's going to be in front. I think Tiznow with that bad post is going to be unable to go with him in the early going. I think Georgie Chavez is going to have this horse in front, and I think it's going to be very tough to catch Albert.
But let's not forget that the favorite did dust Albert the Great by 4 lengths in his comeback race. That was the Jerome at Belmont Park. It was a sensational race for Fusa Ichi Pegasus under Kent DeSormo. This was just a huge effort for this horse. But the question is, granted, he did win the Kentucky Derby at 1.25 miles, but those were against a lot lesser horses than he's facing today. You can't second-guess Neil Drysdale. His record speaks for itself. But if you want to beat Fusa Ichi Pegasus, there's a horse on the board that has enormous odds, in my opinion, right now, and I think he has a legitimate chance, and that's Giant's Causeway. He's the champion of Europe. He won 5 Group 1s in a row this year. He's a son of the great Stormcat, and he loves the distance. Look at the times he's won at this Classic distance. 3 times, that's more than anyone else in the field. Win, lose, or draw, Giant's Causeway is an absolute steal, in my opinion, at 9-1 in this race. But he's not the only one.
Now, we've talked about 3-year-olds. The older horses in here, I think you have to mention, Lemon Drop Kid was the top of his division until 2 races back, and he won that race by a nose. Then the last time, Albert the Great beat him, but if Lemon Drop Kid turns it around, I think he's a contender as well as Cat Thief.
Now, you mentioned Cat Thief, and there he is. And again, this is another son of Stormcat. 3 Stormcats represented in this race, Vision and Verse as well. He won it last year. He's kind of laying in the weeds. Pat Day, Lucas, they got a chance as well.
They always have a chance. Tom?
All right, guys. The cyber cappers like Fusa Ichi Pegasus, 33%. Lemon Drop Kid and Albert the Great. And by the way, is this an omen? Scotty Schulhofer, trainer of Lemon Drop Kid, leaves after this race. He's going to visit his mom. His mom, Hazel, in Aiken, South Carolina, will be 101 years old tomorrow. And there's the star of the moment, Fusa Ichi Pegasus. Will he confirm his brilliance with a victory in the Classic? We'll find out when we return to the Twin Spires of Churchill Downs.
NBC NBC takes a break. I'm Brian Williams. We stay live here at Churchill. Frank Stronach already with two wins here this afternoon. With a win in the Classic, final race of the day, he can make Breeders' Cup history, becoming the first owner to win three races on the same day. Now, he sends out Golden Missile in the Classic. Remember, Golden Missile was third in the Classic last year down at Gulfstream. When we talked with his trainer, Joe Orsino, Orsino said, look, I don't always believe experience counts, but it does count in this particular race.
I've made some changes, and they were all positive. That race really helped us, and maybe it'll help us enough to win it this year. We do a lot of things differently, from equipment to his training schedule, to even the way the rider rides him now because of that race. So hopefully that was the step that will help us have a good year. And he's had a good year, but the step that might make us win this.
Orsino already has two wins here this afternoon. Fusa Ichi Pegasus is the story.
Yes.
Now, Frank Stronach wants to stop him here. He has stopped him before.
Yes, with Red Bullet in the Preakness, and Stronach seems to be one that can stop other people from achieving greatness. When Silver Charm was going for the Triple Crown, got as far as the Belmont Stakes, and boom. Touch Gold was there in the Stronach colors to stop that. We'll see if he can start something here and get his third win on Breeders' Cup Day. It should be very interesting.
All right, Classic coming up. Let's have a quick look at Jim's picks for this final race of the day.
Well, in this particular event, I'm looking at Fusa Ichi Pegasus. It would be great to see him go out. Tiznow from California and Lemon Drop Kid.
And before we go off, we hope to talk to both Stronach and Frosted. Now back to NBC.
In the gloaming at the Downs as post time approaches for the Classic, worth $4,770,000 this year. Captain Steve at 14-1, Golden Missile 13, Cat Thief last year's winner 10-1, Guided Tour a long shot, Albert the Great at 8-1, Lemon Drop Kid 5-1, Dust on the Bottle 60, Fusa Ichi Pegasus 6-5 favorite. You can get 9-1 on Tiznow, and Giant's Causeway is at 8-1. Quality field, Charcy. Fusa Ichi Pegasus off the one race, the Jerome since the Preakness. We saw Neil Drysdale do that with War Chant. And here he is with Fusa Ichi.
Well, of course, we hark back to the Derby conversation earlier. He'd only had five starts, and Neil certainly had him ready to go a mile and a quarter then. A lot happens today, depends on the strategy here. There's some speed from Albert the Great, and there's speed from Captain Steve. Cat Thief is a little bit of the question. The blinker's off. That's interesting. He's usually been up close. The blinkers are off. Pat Day and Wayne Lucas, nobody does the Breeders' Cup better than
those two.
Maybe something's lurking here.
Wayne told me he wanted him to relax a little more. That's why the blinker's off.
Finish with a little more kick. And then, of course, it's Giant's Causeway. The question with him. He has got an American pedigree. There's no reason he should not take to dirt racing. He only shipped in here a few nights ago. Concern did that a few years ago and won the Classic. But he was only coming from Maryland. Giant's Causeway came all the way from Europe. The other big question is at number 14 post position. I mean, it's
right.
A little bit of a shocking experience to have all this happen at once.
Aidan O'Brien did take him, shipped him across the Irish Sea over to England, where they had a dirt and fiber track to give him a taste of what he would experience here at Churchill Downs.
You can do all the schooling you want. Nothing really quite simulates a race, but this is a legitimate world-class racehorse, and to see these two three-year-old champions hook each other is pretty exciting.
There is Fusao Sakaguchi, the owner of Fusa Ichi Pegasus. He's in the software business. He has made and lost a couple of fortunes. He paid $4 million for Fusa Ichi and then sold him for stud duty somewhere 50, 60, 70 million. And there is Fusa Ichi. Donna, he's rambunctious at times. He likes to play and sometimes his own worst enemy. How's he looking at the moment?
Fusa Ichi Pegasus has shown nothing but his tremendous amount of class in the post parade today. He's just done everything perfectly. He's acted like my pony horse here. But I'll tell you another horse, Giant's Causeway, is a horse that is rumored to get very hot over in Europe. I asked Michael Kinane, he looked like he was fine in the post parade today, and he said, yeah, actually he's handling it much better than normal. So I guess that's a good sign for both of those horses. We'll expect the best from them.
All right, Donna, indeed, as they load in good order into the starting gate. As we said, the Classic worth nearly $5 million. Three-year-olds and up over a mile and a quarter. The Breeders' Cup Classic. And for the call, let's go to Tom Durkin.
The field taking their positions for the 17th running of the Breeders' Cup Classic. Gander is moved into line. And the favorite here is Derby winner Fusa Ichi Pegasus, 6-5 on the tote board here at Churchill Downs. Tiznow moving into his post position. And on the outside, Giant's Causeway up to take post position number 14. Giants Causeway walking just a bit behind the starting gate as he makes his first start in America. In fact, his first start on the dirt. Winner of five straight Grade 1 races in Europe this year. The hope of Ireland, the Iron Horse, as he's called over there. Walking just a bit in behind the starting gate. The others loaded quite comfortably. And Giants Causeway in no particular hurry to get into the starting gate today. He's rather rambunctious. He tends to be a little hot and act this way in his races. He's done this in previous races before, and he is really a handful for the assistant starters here at Churchill Downs. What they'll try to do is move around behind him, clasp their hands behind him, perhaps a little extra urging to get into the starting gate. And Donna, what's it look like from your point of view? I'm a quarter of a mile away from him.
They're getting ready to put the red blindfold on him that you saw in Kalanisi earlier, and that was a good sign for Kalanisi. Hopefully it'll get him in. They've had five guys behind him trying to push him into the gate, but he keeps kicking them away from him, so they're not able to get behind him and just push him. But right now they have the blindfold on him. They'll probably try to take a couple of laps around just to confuse him and disorient him a little bit, and then try to take a run at the gate again, where he has a little less indication which way he's headed. You can see again now they're trying to get behind him and lock holds of their hands behind his rear end to push him in, but every time they try to do that, he just kicks at them. I think right now they have the entire starting gate crew pushing him into the gate. There he goes. Well, almost.
Giants Causeway just about in the starting gate. The blindfold has been applied. Soon to take it off. Blindfold off, ready to start the 17th running of the Breeders' Cup Classic. And they're off. Lemon Drop Kid has some speed today. Golden Missile toward the inside. Cat Thief, Captain Steve down toward the rail. Here comes Tiznow from the far outside. So they pass us for the first time. It's Cat Thief and Albert the Great now. Albert the Great comes on through to be the early pacemaker. Tiznow, second on the outside, pressing the pace. Lemon Drop Kid is there. Giants Causeway is going to get caught four wide going into the turn. Vision Inverse is fifth between horses. Cat Thief is sixth toward the inside. Golden Missile going wide into the turn. There was a little traffic trouble there for Guided Tour. Fusaichi Pegasus is seventh at this juncture. He's about six lengths for the lead. Gander to his outside, and Fusaichi Pegasus is moving early. Near the back of the pack, Pine Dance three wide, a length and a half back to Captain Steve, and another five to late running dust on the bottle. The opening quarter goes in 23 2/5 seconds, and it's Tiznow and Albert the Great, and the two three-year-olds in tandem down the back stretch after a solid opening half of 47 2/5 seconds. Ireland's Giants Causeway on the outside third. And then it's Vision Inverse who is in between horses. Lemon Drop Kid toward the inside. The Grey Gander, Fusaichi Pegasus, is still about six lengths from the lead with four furlongs remaining. Captain Steve has moved through an opening toward the inside. Golden Missile, Cat Thief, last year's winner, has dropped off the pace now. And then it's Pine Dance as the field rounds the far turn. Albert the Great and Tiznow, they continue to go at it. Giants Causeway is called on for his run. Lemon Drop Kid is fourth toward the inside. Gander is fifth. Vision Inverse is sixth. Fusaichi Pegasus is toiling. The field comes off the turn. Tiznow on the outside. Albert the Great on the rail. The two of them continue to go at it. Here comes Giants Causeway for Ireland on the outside. They're coming into the final furlong. Tiznow tough as nails. Giants Causeway on the outside. Giants Causeway and Tiznow battling head to head. A heart pounding, pulsating stretch drive, and Tiznow prevails. Tiznow has won it by a nose over Giants Causeway, and it was close for third there between Captain Steve and Albert the Great. Fusaichi Pegasus ran an uninspiring race today, finishing in the middle of the pack. And the final time here was 2 minutes and 3/5 of a second. Tom Hammond, back to you. Another thrilling renewal of the Breeders' Cup Classic.
Indeed, Tom Durkin, great job. And Tiznow, a three-year-old, won the Classic, but it wasn't Fusaichi Pegasus. It was Tiznow as he beat his fellow three-year-old Giants Causeway to the wire. It looked like Giants Causeway was going to go by him deep in the stretch, but Tiznow able to dig deep and find something special, becoming the first California-bred winner of a Breeders' Cup race. Donna.
I'm here with Chris McCarron, the winning rider, jubilant winning rider Chris McCarron. Chris, tell me about your
show money. So Tiznow had been brilliant his last two, but some questions whether he had raced too often in a short amount of time. Didn't look like it today. Giants Causeway hooked him right here. You thought Giants Causeway was going to go by him, but Chris McCarron asked Tiznow for more, and this colt by C's Tizzy had it. He had the strength left after a mile and a quarter to hold off Europe's best and win the Breeders' Cup Classic. Chris McCarron with another winning Breeders' Cup ride. This one on Tiznow with a celebration.
If you work around the house, don't you sometimes wish you had a third hand? Well, I now have a third and a fourth hand since I discovered a great new idea from Mastercraft. The Mastercraft Lock Chop, exclusive to Canadian Tire. It is the most ingenious and easy way to hold anything together. Where conventional clamps would also require a third hand to install, you can use the lock jaw with just one. It adjusts perfectly, and its ratchet tightening action ensures a strong grip.
Without having to use a lot of strength, the adjustment is so precise it can hold together awkward pieces. The precise step-locking design makes it as gentle or as powerful as you need. You choose the pressure, and it locks in position. To unlock it, just press the quick-release trigger. You'll discover hundreds of uses in and around the house.
Wherever you need a helping hand, the Mastercraft Lockjaw will provide the perfect grip to help you do the job.
Get a set of Mastercraft Lockjaws starting at only $9.99 per pair.
No toolbox is complete without the helping hand of the Mastercraft Lockjaws.
Get yours now, only at Canadian Tire.
The flu, a serious and highly contagious disease that affects everyone, young and old. Just think about how many ways you can catch the flu right here. By not getting your flu shot, you could give the flu to someone else too. Perhaps even someone at risk who could wind up in the hospital with serious complications, including bronchitis, pneumonia, kidney failure, and even heart failure. Protect yourself. Protect your family. Get the flu shot.
With two new and easy ways to play ProLine Sports, which is better? Let's see. ProLine's now improved with better odds and over-under all on one ticket. A strong contender. But wait. Here's new and easy Pro Picks. Just like a sports pool, choose top players or teams. Who will win?
Maybe you, if you get to your lottery retailer now.
But seriously, guys, is it really about win or lose?
Uh-oh.
I guess so.
She loves playing Adele. It's her happy place.
Were you eating fish?
I had a lobster roll.
Use a fork next time. It's all over my face.
Megan follows guest stars on the next Made in Canada, Monday at 8:30 on CBC.
Tiznow has thrown the three-year-old championship picture, maybe even horse of the year, balloting into a tizzy as Chris McCarron gets his fourth win in the Breeders' Cup Classic, his eighth Breeders' Cup win overall. And to take a look on it for our Morgan Stanley Dean Witter Classic replay, here's Trevor.
Well, that was an aptly raced name, that's for sure, the Classic. Look at Tiznow on the lead out here. That's him in just taking over on the extreme outside. Here's going to come Giants Causeway to put up a really good rally out of there. And it's going to be Chris McCarron and Mick Kinney, one of the best of America and one of the best in Europe, head and head. And one never likes to get too euphoric right after a race. But I believe this was one of Chris McCarron's greatest rides ever. Yes, the horse Tiznow did all the work out there, but look at Chris McCarron, not a stick ride, just a hand pushing hard as he could. Perfect tandem with Tiznow. He knew that it was coming to the end of a mile and a quarter race. The horse probably didn't have all that much left. McCarron just kept him balanced, let the horse do all the work, and as you know, this guy's got a heart as big as the track. He was not going to let Giants Causeway go by him. Great ride by Chris McCarron, and a great training job as well by Jay Robbins. First California-bred win in a Breeders' Cup, and the first Breeders' Cup win for Jay Robbins as well. A really great climax to a great afternoon's racing.
All right, Trevor, let's go to Kenny Rice. He's with Kent DeSormo, who rode the favorite, Fusa Ichi Pegasus.
Thanks, Tom. Giants Causeway came over and lived up to his hype. Coming into this one, Fusa Ichi Pegasus, so much expected in his return to Churchill Downs. What happened out there, Kent?
Well, I think he had too much respect in the fact that all the, you know, a lot of bouncing around, horses inside and outside of me, trying to push him back or put him in a spot where they could better their chances, and they obviously did that job very well because he stayed real strong in the bridle with having to carry horses for 40 yards at a time. took off, but unfortunately, just things didn't work out.
Did you think you had a lot still there when he was able to get out? Did you think you still could catch up?
No, it was, he had kind of just, I thought there was going to be too much work to do at that time. He did take off when I first got him out and gave him somewhere to go, but unfortunately the pace wasn't very, very strong, and I was possibly a little bit too far back, and the big strapping colt, they're bouncing off of him. He wanted to carry on, and I said no, not yet, and finally by the time we got halfway down the backside, he just fell off the bridle and turned in on the fight.
Okay, thank you very much. Kent DeSormo, Fusiachi Pegasus did it here on the first Saturday in May, but not on the first Saturday in November. Back to you, Tom.
All right, Kenny, and interesting that the two outside posts run 1-2. Tiznow was in 13, Giants Causeway in 14. Michael Cooper and Cecilia Straub Rubens, who bred this colt in California, are the owners, and they put up $360,000 to make him a supplemental nominee, and did it pay off big time as trainer Jay Robbins gets his first Breeders' Cup win. Three-year-old colt by C's Tizzy from C's Song by Seattle Song. Tiznow wins the Breeders' Cup Classic. Here's the complete order of finish. Fusaichi finished sixth. Cat Thief was seventh. We'll be back in a moment.
Over 70 million people
are receiving an education on the internet this year.
7 out of 10 students on the web
say they are getting better grades.
One day, training for every job on Earth.
Training for every job on Earth will be available on the internet.
Are you ready?
Are you ready?
Are you ready?
Virtually all internet traffic travels across the systems of one company, Cisco Systems, empowering the internet generation.
Are you ready?
Are you?
Some extra stuff you don't need? Well, you can forget the classifieds. Bring it to Cash Converters and get cash for it instantly. You'll probably also find stuff you do want. Discover Cash Converters, a better way to sell, a great place to shop.
It's part of trying to connect with our viewers.
A nightly note from Peter Mansbridge.
It's really an attempt to demystify the process of the newscast and give viewers an opportunity to understand how we do our job, why we make the decisions we make every day.
An opportunity to see your political leaders in action as they debate the issues of the day. Ann Medina hosts live coverage of the Leaders' Debate Thursday night at 8 Eastern on CBC Television. The Cisco Breeders' Cup on CBC. Brought to you by Cisco Systems, empowering the internet generation.
Back live at Churchill Downs here in Kentucky. Along with Jim Bannon, I'm Brian Williams. It has been a big day for Frank Stronach, and Frank Stronach will join us here live in just a minute. Also quite a day for Sampson Farm. Sampson Farm won the turf in 1997 with Chief Bearhart in California. Very nearly did it today here with Quiet Resolve. We'll talk to Mark Frosted, Tammy Samuel Belize in just a minute. But Jim Bannon, how about the finish of the Turf Classic here this afternoon?
It was looking so good for so long in the stretch. At 40-1, it looked like Quiet Resolve, who some think have have distance limitations. Maybe he wasn't going to get there, but the farther they went through the stretch, the Sampson horse in red in between horses desperately trying to hang on with Sellers. On the outside, it's Kelenissi who comes up for the Aga Khan and nips them. Some real powerhouses of racing involved in this finish, and a tough loss for Canada, but a great, obviously, effort.
Well, as promised, joining us from Sampson Farm, Tammy Samuel-Balaz, and there's Mark Frostag. Congratulations to you both. We did this before following the turf, did we not? Once out in California, Mark?
It was a little warmer then.
It was indeed. Listen, Tammy, I'll talk to you in just a minute. Mark, let me begin with you. We were out here Thursday morning, bright and early. You were talking to Jim, and we used the clip earlier. You were very much concerned about this mile and a half distance.
Well, it's no question about it. It's at the very limits of his capabilities. But, you know, this horse is a real scrapper, and he's got a heart as big as the Northwest Territories. He just really dug in and ran a super race. We were very pleased with him.
Tammy, let me ask you, a big loss, obviously, for your family, for the Canadian industry, your father passing away, Ernie Samuel, who was a director of this event back in May. I'm always asked, what about Sampson Farm in the future? Will you still be committed to big-time racing?
Absolutely. No, the farm has a long history and I think a long and happy future, and this is what Dad built and what we love to be a part of, so we continue on proudly and try to do him proud.
Tammy, it's obviously a great foundation that you have at Sampson Farm, and you could tell that in the pedigrees of many of the horses that you run over time. Tell us about some of your feelings about the Queen's Plate and the Canadian Oaks this year, and then getting to the Breeders' Cup.
Well, as you mentioned, I mean, it's been an incredible year for us. So sad to lose Dad earlier, but, you know, to have the highlights that we've had, to win the Queen's Plate was incredible, and the Oaks, it just seemed so unreal in such a such a terrible year. But these are highlights that are just incredible. So to be here today, and this horse has been a sentimental favorite, so we're thrilled, absolutely thrilled. We feel like he won it.
Mark, let me ask you, we were talking about this horse. He had some challenges. He had a bleeding problem. You had to take him out of Canada and bring him to a place where they had more liberal medication rules. Tell us about that aspect of Quiet Resolve.
Well, when he ran on the soft turf at Woodbine, he bled during the race, and after that we knew we had to get him out of there where we could use a little more Lasix. It's 5 cc's in Canada, up to 10 in the U.S., but notwithstanding that, he didn't bleed his last race in Kentucky, and he ran a great race today.
Well, congratulations to you both. Let's hold going to commercial for just a minute. I want Jim to explain what Lasix is for those people that aren't involved in horse racing. Tammy, congratulations. Mark, congratulations. Thank you for joining us here today as Quiet Resolve is second. Very quickly, what is Lasix?
So horses under stress sometimes bleed internally, and this is a medication that helps prevent that. You can't have as much of it at Woodbine and in Canada as you can here, and I thought Quiet Resolve benefited from being in Kentucky in his last race and today as well.
Well, Quiet Resolve, one of the big Canadian stories here today. The other one involves Frank Stronach, and I understand we are wiring Frank up. He will join us live here in just a minute. Frank Stronach winning two races today. He won with Perfect Sting and Macho Uno. Of course, the last time the Breeders' Cup was here, Stronach won with Awesome Again. So Frank Stronach has now got three victories in the Breeders' Cup going ahead of Sampson Farm. And I understand Frank can hear us. He is wired up and will join us here in just a second. Frank, Brian Williams, and Jim Bannon, congratulations.
Thank you. It was a nice day. Great day.
Frank, we did this, I think, 2 years ago after Awesome Again. You've now won with a Canadian bred. That's Awesome Again. A couple of American breds today, Perfect Sting and Macho Uno. You're a force both in our country and here in the United States. Talk to us about your commitment to racing in Canada.
Well, as you know, I got my farm up in Canada. My family lives up there. My son is up there. So our world head office is in Toronto, Canada. So I'm committed. We have a lot of Canadian breds, and we do want to race up there, yeah.
Frank, these are homebreds that you were winning with today. Anything special about that?
Well, the special is I think we got great farms, and I think we got a great program, a great team, and we try to do the right things. If you do the right things, then the winning will come.
Frank, you're now owning major racetracks in this country, Santa Anita, Gulfstream, and others. Any plans to buy racetracks in our country?
Well, I guess it would be nice to buy Woodbine, yeah.
I was thinking maybe Vancouver. Yes, Woodbine. Do you have any plans to buy tracks in Canada?
Well, I wouldn't say never, but it's possible, but we'll see.
One of the great ironies of today was obviously your feud with the NTRA, the National Racing Association, and to have Tim Smith, the president of that organization that you're feuding with currently, to present you with the trophy for your big win. How did you feel about that?
Well, first of all, I don't feud. I got no problem. I'm a great believer we should have a national organization. But last year, around this time, I said, look, we will try. We'd be paying in and be a member for one more year. But I have three concerns, and I expressed those. One was, this organization should, the board of directors should be elected by its stakeholders in a democratic way. That was one of the conditions. The second condition was the mandate has to be defined, what this organization is supposed to do. And thirdly, a commitment to free enterprise. So within the whole year, they haven't done anything of that. So I said, look, you guys think about that. If you're going to implement some of that, then we'd be happy to join again.
All right, Frank, I know you have to go. Congratulations, two wins today. Thank you for joining us. Frank Stronach.
Okay, it was a great day.
All right,
thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you for joining us. Jim, some quick thoughts as we wrap it up. Get ready to join Women Making Waves, the documentary about the women's water polo team leading up to the Sydney Olympics.
Well, the Breeders' Cup is big business. It's big gaming and big gambling, and that was the case today. There was people that paid a lot of money to get their horses in these races that didn't pay off. People like the Coolmore Association, they came close in the last race, but they paid a lot of money for Fusaichi Pegasus. It did not pay off. They paid a lot of money for AP Valentine. It didn't pay off. Ribaletta in the first race, $400,000 to get her in the race. It didn't pay off.
Well, at the top of the show, we talked about great Canadian stories. Northern Dancer, Sonny's Halo, Dan Smartley, awesome again here at Churchill Downs. More Canadian stories again today. Always good to work with you, Jim. Thank you. The Canadian stories, of course, the Sampson Farm finishing second in the turf, and Frank Stronach with two wins. Let's take a look at what's coming up tonight. Just a reminder, 6:30 Eastern, 3:30 on the West Coast. Toronto at St. Louis follows Labatt Saturday night, and that will be followed...